My talk is going to be very different than all of the talks that you've heard so far. It'll be different in two ways. First, the talks that you've heard so far have largely covered a few specific pieces of research, taking them apart, showing you how they're done, talking about what we can learn from them, so on and so forth. And I'm not going to do that. Instead, I'm going to cover just touch upon a very vast body of material and give you a taste of stuff and kind of a guide to where you might go on your own to learn more about this. I'm doing this largely because I thought that if I were to take some like fancy game theory paper and take it apart to Dolby before I got done with the definitions. Second thing is I am going to be talking about economic theory in the intellectual space here. I am one of the extreme points. I'm going to talk a little bit about empirical work, but mostly about theory. Now, I asked last night at dinner, and most of you said that you'd had some economic theory. Is that right? Raise your hand if you've had some microeconomics at the graduate level. Okay, well, don't be so shy. All right. If you're like American graduate students, most of you say, okay, this first year micro course is something that I have to get through before I can get to labor economics and health economics and do what I really want to do. This is like learning Latin, and maybe about as useful, especially if you're in labor economics. And that's for you. And
I'm listening.
So I'm waiting for labor economics to go the way that IO has, right? And I think that will be, I'm waiting to see who the Ariel Vegas of labor economics is going to be. So in any event, I think, and that will probably be a long wait, but theory, I think, is much more important than everybody gives them credit for. It's not just, that part of that little paragraph in the paper that you need to have your little theory model that you talk about before you go on and actually get to the serious part with the numbers. The fact is that every time you make a causal claim, you are making a theoretical statement, okay? It is the case, and Jim Heckman said this in a very pithy way in an article, that causality is a property of the model. It's a property of a model, okay? Whether causation actually exists in the world is an independent thing, is something that philosophers can argue about, and there are different opinions on what causation might mean. But for us, right, causation is how we think things happen in the world, and how we can change what happens by changing things in the world. Okay, so a very popular set of causal models that philosophers use today are called perturbation theories. And the idea of a perturbation theory is that how can we say if A causes B? Well, if we jiggle A and leave everything else alone and B wiggles, then we can say, aha, there's an effect, so A must be a cause. The first kind of really worked out example of this kind of stuff done in any kind of analytic way was actually due to Marshall, right? This is what supply and demand is about, right? You jiggle some parameters of this thing that we call the supply function, and wow, you watch the price move, okay? And so we say, these parameters must in fact cause prices. There's a long tradition of this kind of thinking, which actually goes back to David Hume, but the point I want to make is that these are, you can't address causation without having at least implicitly a theoretical model, okay? It's easier to have a conversation about that work, about the work that you've done, if you can make that theoretical model a little bit more explicit. Much of the conversation that goes on in empirical workshops, when people wonder about, is your instrument any good, or is this endogenous or is this not? These are really statements about a theoretical model. Okay, identification is essentially where theory and empirical work meet. Being sensitive to the kinds of formal models that can actually generate, to tell the kind of stories that you're thinking about, I think an important part of not all, but a lot of good empirical work. All right, today's your dose of economic theory, and of course we'll have a qualifying exam at the end of the evening. Just so you're ready. So the other thing I want to say is that what I'm going to do is talk about work, the essential question that I want to talk about today is, what is the relationship between economic phenomena and other kinds of social phenomena, right? So, of course, we all participate in markets, right? We buy and we sell, and we get paid wages and all that kind of stuff, right? But we also have friends, we have family, we have obligations that we owe to people, so on and so forth. And these two domains, the economic and the social, are not separate. They're intertwined. They interact. I want to talk about how they relate. Now, you might think that this would be the domain of behavioral economics, right? But the fact of the matter is that it's not, and I think it's one of the reasons why, for me, it's one of the reasons why I believe that behavioral economics is actually a rather sterile enterprise, because behavioral economics has to do, a lot of behavioral economics has to do, many of the behavioral talks that I go to, have to do with models of decision making, how do people decide things, right? And notice how unstable various, this notion of preference that we have actually is, and things of this kind. I think that this is all stuff that has been actually well understood for a very long time. And what the behavioral economists are doing now, which is a good thing, is actually kind of figuring out practical implications from that. But they essentially have a static view of where the components of decision making inside of us come from. So their model, Ariel Rubinstein once said that behavioral economics is just regular economics with funny looking utility functions. they're completely different places. And if you read a lot of behavioral economics, you can see that, well, there's something like that. There's some truth to that. But I think that what goes on when we think about social life is that there's really something much more radical happening. So the first thing is that we need to think about is the fact that our preferences over life, and we talk about preferences, right? And these preferences sit there. We reveal them when we act in markets, right? We reveal them when we go to the grocery store or go to the restaurant or choose this or choose that. So preference is supposed to represent our intentionality. It's not about happiness, it's not what makes you happy or what doesn't make you happy, but it's about your intentions at the moment of choice. And sometimes those intentions are very durable, and other times these intentions are less durable. They might last only for a moment. Preferences are basically a way of encoding, for example, choice data. They're a way of encoding choice data. And if you go back and read Paul Samuelson's revealed preference paper, the one that he wrote when he was something like 18 or 19 years old or something like that, you'll see that this is exactly his point of view. I don't want to repeat what I said. It's just it's a way of representing choice. It doesn't have any kind of deep psychology behind it. But wherever you think it's coming from, whatever you think its duration, in most received economic theory and in most behavioral economics as well, with one big exception that I'll come to in just a second, these things are fixed inside of us, right? So you have your preference order. You have your preference order. I have mine. Okay, and so this governs our behavior over some run of time. Sociologists take kind of a different view. Their view is that preferences are to, at least to some degree, our behaviors are socially constructed. Okay, and if you think about what it would mean to have our preferences constructed by our interactions with others, this would really have to radically change the way in which we do economics. So, for example, let's take an important concept from economic theory that I'm sure you all know, and this is Pareto optimality. Right? We always talk about what kinds of policies are good, what kinds of policies are bad. We talk about Pareto improvements. Okay? Well, how can we talk about Pareto improvements if the policy that we enact actually changes preferences? Right? How would we, what would be our measuring stick? Okay. In the conventional models, the preferences are the same after the policy as before, and so those are the obvious measuring sticks, and that's what we use. Okay. But when our preferences are actually changing, do we use the before preferences? Do we use the after preferences? Should we have some kind of way of thinking about what's good and what's bad that sits above individual preferences? That's a very different perspective, right, from the way in which we do welfare economics. And this, by the way, is an area that has not been thought out a lot, and I think that is there anyone in the room who's a budding theorist? Nah. Okay. Last year there was one. So these, I think, are really important problems that economists are going to begin to deal with in coming years. Let's see what the right button here. There is one area where we actually can see preference construction. Okay. And this might surprise you, but this is in the theory of non-cooperative games. How many of you know what a Nash equilibrium is? Now, last night at dinner, more of y'all told me, yeah, I've had game theory, right? So come on, who knows what a Nash equilibrium is, right? Okay, some of you do, a good number of you do, but not enough. Okay, take a theory course. Okay. and your hand isn't up, you have to take a theory course. The idea, think about what a Nash equilibrium is. Let's think for a moment about a finite game, and think about, there's a theorem that says that every finite game, and this is Nash's theorem, right, every finite game has a Nash equilibrium in mixed strategies, right? So someone quick, tell me what a mixed strategy is. Yeah. You're on, go for it. Okay, right, I said I can distribute probability, that's right, I can randomize, right? So we're playing, how many of you know the game Matching Pennies? Have you heard this game, right? So what do we do in Matching Pennies? You have a penny, I have a penny, and the two sides of the coin are distinct, and so we, secretly we can put them down, choose a side, we put it down on the table, we uncover our hands, and if they're the same, you pay me a lot of money, if they're different, then I pay you a lot of money. And what's the right way to play this game? The right way to play this game is to flip the coin, right? Okay, because why? Because you want to be maximally unpredictable, right? And the best way to be maximally unpredictable is to randomize, and that's the best way I can think of to randomize, okay? So fine, we have a theory of how to play matching pennies. Now, when we build economic models, when we build game theoretic models to talk about policy analysis, how many of us think that, say, policymakers randomize? Mm-hmm. Can you imagine sitting there in some government ministry, these guys flipping coins? I mean, sometimes it might feel that way, right? But really, I think it is weird determinism, right? How are we to understand Nash equilibrium then if we don't really think that people are randomizing? Well, one way of understanding them is Nash equilibrium is the following. What is a Nash equilibrium? A Nash equilibrium is a probability distribution over choices available to every player in the game. Okay. So think for a moment about what the role of those probability distributions are. If you and I are playing a two-person game, right? There is a prescription. There are these probability distributions that form, a probability distribution. You one for me that together describe the Nash equilibrium, and what is the purpose of that probability distribution in the theory? This probability distribution over your actions actually represents my beliefs, okay, about how you're going to play, okay, and the probability distribution over my actions represents your beliefs over how I'm going to play, okay, and then the fundamental idea of Nash equilibrium is. You're best responding with respect to your beliefs, and I'm best responding with respect to my beliefs, and our beliefs are not inconsistent with actual play. Okay? So as Roger Meyerson points out in his game theory text, one way of understanding Nash equilibrium is simply to say that You have some beliefs. I have some beliefs. Okay. You have beliefs about me. I have beliefs about you. The support of your beliefs about me are exactly the support of your beliefs. The set of things that get positive probability are exactly the actions that are best responses of me to my beliefs about you, and vice versa. So it's really all about beliefs. Okay. So now let's think about how game theory actually works. Savage. How many of you know the name Jimmy Savage? Leonard Savage. One or two of you. You do. Okay. So you're a very educated guy. Leonard Savage was a statistician who wrote a book called The Foundations of Statistics in 1954. Now, expected utility has been with us at least since the 16th century. Would you say that's right, Stephen? I'm thinking about Descartes, right? And Bernoulli, of course, was the guy who first actually made an explicit expected utility argument, at least the first one I know of. If you look at decision theory in the early 1950s, late 1940s, all kinds of suggestions for how we should think about decision making under uncertainty, they're all out there. People were talking about things like the Albert criteria. They were talking about things like minimax regret and maximin and stuff like this. And expected utility was just one of the many things that was talked about. It was something that that von Neumann and Waterston had written about in the second edition of their text. Okay. Savage comes and writes this book called The Foundations of Statistics. And what he does in this book is to say, imagine that you have preference ordering over random objects. And these random objects are acts, they're maps from states of the world into outcomes, and you don't know what the state of the world is going to be, but you have a preference order over these things. And Savage says, if these preference orders have certain properties, then we can represent your preference order by a probability distribution and a function, a kind of a utility function, a payoff function, from outcomes into real numbers, such that we rank X by computing their expected payoff with respect to this probability distribution. And that's expected utility theory, right? All right, so from this point of view, from Savage's point of view, and this is a very popular point of view today, still today, we talk about subjective expected utility, right? And everybody has their beliefs. Everybody has their taste, which is represented by this payoff function. We put them together in some way, and this generates a preference order and generates a choice. Now think about a game. One way of understanding the game, okay, is that we all come into the room to play the game, not with a single preference order, but with a family of preference orders. And these family of preference orders that we have are the preference orders that come about from the single payoff function that we have and all the possible beliefs that we can have about how each other play the game. Okay? And then we play the game, we achieve a Nash equilibrium somehow, and what has that Nash equilibrium done? That Nash equilibrium has in fact chosen beliefs for each of us out of all the possible beliefs that we can have. Okay? So our preferences are somehow constructed by this interaction. Now, what component of our preferences have been constructed? It's not the taste component, okay? That's fixed, okay? But it's the belief component, okay? So this is a theory of social construction of preferences. Now, it's not too exciting a theory in some way, because what we have this idea. This, by the way, is really foreign to Savage, but Savage just says, look, there's just these preference orders, and utility functions and belief, these all have the same kind of standing with respect to preferences. Just Savage might well say, okay, that if we're talking about, for example, betting on an election or betting on a football game or something like this, that you have your beliefs and I have my beliefs. And just as we can't really argue with each other about our tastes. You have your tastes, I have my tastes, whatever they are, okay? Savage would say the same thing about beliefs. You have your beliefs, I have my beliefs, right? Most of us actually think differently. We say, no, my beliefs really could be wrong, right? So it's different changing my beliefs than it is changing my taste, right? You might come and argue with me, and it's sensible for you if you know that you're right to come and convince me of your point of view, where it's not, sensible for you to come and convince me that pink is really a pretty color, okay? Because it's just not. No offense to any of you who are older than me. This idea that preferences are socially determined and kind of embedded in social life is a key distinction between economics and sociology. And now you've had all the time in the world to read this and to read this. And these two quotations from two scholars represent two very distinct points of view, the economic and kind of the extreme sociological point of view about the nature of preferences and the nature of choice. Okay. I know that the Chicago economists in the room will recognize this quotation, and you know Chicago economists in the room. Ware Duesenberry wrote this. He was actually commenting on a paper of Gary Becker's, and I need to get just a second. I need the other thumb. Okay. This is the beginning of Duesenberry's comment on Becker's paper about education. But Duesenberry here actually went on to say that the sociological view is in some sense, you know, a compelling thing to think about. I want to read this, because Duesenberry went on to say, having written this sentence, he said, "There is no one in this room, not even Gary Becker, who considers himself free to choose either two children who go to university or four children who stop their education after high school." So lots of our choices, right, are constrained by social convention. Our preferences are, in fact, determined by social convention. And this is what I want to talk about when we talk about social interaction. Okay, and let me find a little button here and move along. So I'm going to talk about what are called, and this is a very bad phrase, and I think it's student interlock, so. blame him. So I'm going to talk about what are called social interaction models. Okay, and these are models of how individuals interact with each other in ways that are not necessarily directly through market transactions that end up having an impact on market outcomes. And so I provided in the left-hand column a list, and it's a very partial list, of areas in economics, topics that economists write on, where you can find what I would call social interaction models. And I've written on the right a bunch of different kinds of social interaction mechanisms. How do social interaction models work? How do we influence each other? Okay, well, one way we influence each other is through peer effects, right? So if I go to a formal dinner and I go in, you know, shorts and flip-flops, right, I'm going to be stigmatized by people. People are going to look at me funny, no one's going to want to sit with me, right, and I'm not going to feel particularly good, right, assuming that I like the people and want to be there. I'm going to a wedding next Tuesday, right, and I, you know, I'll have to have my nice sport coat. I can't show up in a t-shirt. I'll feel bad if I do, right? I'll be stigmatized by you. There are many people, for all of us, I think, have individuals that we look up to, great teachers who have really influenced us, parents, other important people in our lives. Those are role models. There are standards of behavior that are set by society in ways that we might not really understand. But most of us, when we play the ultimatum game, do you all know what the ultimatum game is? Right, this is the game where I take a pile of money, say 100 RMB, and I choose a split, and I can say I'm going to take this part of the money, and you can have that part of the money, and you have to either accept or reject it. And if you reject it, we get nothing, and if you accept it, then we implement the split. Right? Now, how many in the room are going to say, "Well, I'll take all the money for myself"? We're here. You know, we're talking about 100. You can have one. Right? Most of us would just feel odd doing that, right? That's kind of a norm, right? We want to treat the other person fairly. Now, by the way, it turns out that oftentimes people don't go to 50-50, right? Maybe 60-40, right? So there's kind of a norm of fairness there. Social learning, right? You want to go out to dinner tonight, right? So what do? You ask a friend, "Is that new restaurant any good?" Okay, so that's social learning. Social learning is very important when we think about things like the diffusion of new technologies, right? When we think about, there's a, A nice paper that I was going to talk about today, but I've decided I won't have time to, having to do with the diffusion of a new variety of pineapple in Ghana. This is a paper by Chris Udry, who we heard about yesterday, and Tim Conley. It is not on my reading list, but it's worth reading. It's in the, AER, I think, right? Social capital, who knows what social capital means, but that's, how many of you have ever heard the phrase social capital? Okay, a few of you have. I don't know how much of you, we'll probably not talk much about that today. But social capital is, in fact, a very important idea, and it's kind of underlying, I think, all that we're talking about. So, moving along. What are ways of studying social interactions? Well, there's the standard thing of building an economic model, some kind of game theoretic type model, and estimating it, right? And that's what we would all think of doing, right? But there are other ways, right, that one can study how people, you know, affect one another. I've listed three here. Ethnographies, right, done by, typically by anthropologists or people like them. It's amazing to me how many of my economist colleagues have disdain for qualitative data. Okay, if there's not a column of numbers, they're not really happy. Okay, I think that this is not a good point of view. On the other hand, so what do ethnographers do? They go out and they live with people, or they spend a lot of time talking to people, interviewing them, and then they kind of, you know, write up what they've learned. And there is a puzzle, right? How do we know that the stories that they tell are not just kind of selected in some kind of odd way, some kind of self-serving way? Just the same way you wonder, you know, how do we know whether a piece of empirical research, you know, is good? Well, we know what to do. You know, we ask, well, is your instrument a good instrument? Did you worry about this? Did you worry about that? And I once asked a sociologist, a friend of mine, how one could really tell whether an ethnography was any good or not. And instead of giving me an answer, she gave me a list of about 5 or 6 ethnographies and said, you know, which do you like and which not? And I gave her, and I had read them all, and I gave her my partition. And she said, yeah, that's my partition too. So you see, you just know. That's really uncomfortable, okay? but nonetheless, I think that, you know, that ethnographic research is really valuable for us as both a source of hypotheses and kind of a way of kind of checking our results against the world. Field experiments, okay? I'll be talking about some field experiments later on. This is where we go, not in a laboratory, but we go into the world and we do experiments. RCTs, right? You all know what RCTs are, right? And RCTs are good examples of field experiments. There are also very large-scale natural experiments. So yesterday, I think it was Lauren raised the issue, wasn't it? It was in the morning, the issue was raised about, could we do, you know, randomized trials for some kind of experiments in migration, right? You really can't imagine, you know, picking, you know, a sample of, you know, 5,000 villages randomly and say, okay, all you people move to the city. On the other hand, you know, there have been very large, in different countries, there have been very large-scale experiments where things, you know, like tax rates or stuff like this have been effectively been changed specifically to learn something about the behavior of large populations. And these are research methodologies that many of us, I think, in this room are not too familiar with. But it's worth knowing something about. Let's move on. So what kind of questions do I want to ask today? Largely what I'm going to talk about today are pure effects more than anything else. I'm going to talk about social network models. And I want to talk about what are appropriate tools for modeling social interactions. One of the things that I want to look for when I think about social effects. I want to think about things at two levels. I want to think about what's going on at a very micro level. How is it that you are affecting me? Right? How are my decisions changed? Or how is the decision of any one agent in our subject pool, how are they affected by the behaviors of others? Okay. So I want a very micro description of what's going on. And then on the other hand, What I'm ultimately interested in at the end of the day are what are the systemic effects of that, right? So when our behavior is integrated together, right, what are the large-scale implications for society as a whole? These are two questions that are asked at very different levels of aggregation. And there's a very nice phrase that I learned to describe this many years ago at the Santa Fe Institute, but it's okay anyway, Stephen. This phrase is emergent properties. Okay. So what do we mean when we say that something is an emergent property? When we have a system of individuals interacting in some way, think about some kind of game theoretic model, right? The game theoretic model, what we do is we describe, right? Or better yet, actually a market model, right? So think about just supply and demand. You go to the market, right? We have a model that says what you're going to choose is a function of price and income, so on and so forth. And we have a model of the firms on the other side, how much they want to produce. And we have lots of firms, we have lots of consumers. The driving equations of the model, right, are the equations of the behavioral equations of the model are the equations at the individual level. Okay. Now, what comes out of that and the equilibrium condition of market clearing is a price. Okay. The price is something that exists at a different level of aggregation, right, at a different scale, right, than do the individual behaviors of the many, many agents, many, many actors in this model. And so that kind of property, price is an example of an emergent property. Right, something that is a regularity that exists in the system, which is at a that is defined or appears at a level which is different than that of the driving equations of the system, and we're going to be looking for emergent properties. So, let me give you a brief example of what I mean. You don't want to read all this. So this is a paper that some criminologist wrote about juvenile crime in America, actually in particular in the city of Philadelphia. And the question that these guys wanted to ask, boy, they write badly, don't they? The question that these guys wanted to ask was are there peer effects on repeated criminal behavior by young people, by teenagers or very young adults? Okay? That's the question they wanted to ask. If people just go out and decide to be criminals, or to what extent are they influenced by their peers? And who are their peers, okay? And what are the implications of that? So what they did was they built, and I'm not going to talk about any of this stuff, but everybody's had a slide with numbers. Okay, so here's mine, okay? And what these guys did was they built a logit model to describe the behavior, the probability that an individual who had already been arrested once for juvenile crime would commit that crime or another kind of crime again. Okay? And the logit model took as independent variables all these things here on the left-hand side, and you can see, I know you're not too interested in juvenile crime in the United States, so I'm not going to go into this in any detail, but the point is that they spent a lot of time figuring out, right, essentially estimating behavioral models, okay, of individuals. So then, what they did was they said, okay, well, what are the implications of that, right? In order to determine one of the variables, I should have pointed this out. Let me go back. One of the variables here is notice this last variable here. Contagion effects. Okay. So what they want to know is how many people in your little local neighborhood are people who have committed multiple crimes. Right. So some of you might live in neighborhoods where there's not a lot of criminal behavior, and in particular, not very many people who have committed multiple crimes. And other people might live in large neighborhoods, in neighborhoods where there is a lot of crime. Right? And now the question is, what's the impact of that on the overall pattern of crime in the system? And you can see that this coefficient here is a positive coefficient that is quite significant. And the implication of this is that we see lots of clustering of criminal activity. So what they did here was to essentially plot out areas where people had high probabilities of committing crime and low probabilities of committing crime based on the model, and you can see that you get a lot of clustering, which also is what you see in the data. So the aggregate behavior, so the micro-level behavior, right, the driving equation, you're just, you know, what's the probability that you're going to commit a crime given your characteristics, okay, what's your probability, so on and so forth. The aggregate behavior, the emergent property, is the clustering, okay, that we see. And so this has implications for what kind of policies you might want to engage in, right? If you want to have an impact, if you want to reduce juvenile crime rates, okay? And they found actually many more and very interesting things. If any of you are interested in crime, this paper's on the reading list, and you can take a look at it. Here's another paper that had a big impact in the economics community by Ed Glaser, Sacerdote, and Joseph Schenkman. This is in the QJE in 1996. I don't remember the title of the paper.
Crime and Social Interactions.
Crime and Social Interactions. Did they invent the phrase? What is this paper about? Hang on one second. These guys were interested in kind of a surprising feature of crime rates in U.S. data. If you look at crime rates, rates of criminal activity, and you look across cities in the United States, see that there's a great deal of variance, right? Some cities have really high crime rates, some cities have really low crime rates, and that seemed to them to be more than could be explained, okay, by, the typical models where we have a bunch of people making choices that depends upon individual characteristics, and there are these, IID shocks and so on and so forth, right? We see more variance in the data than the standard kind of models should actually, produce. So they wanted to figure out, right, this is, again, a macro property, it's an emergent property, right? Because we don't have, we want to think about the individual behaviors, the sources of individual behaviors, that in fact might account for this excess variance that we actually see. That's the puzzle that this paper started to solve, okay? And the paper is a very, at the end of the day, well, let's just see what the model looks like. So what they did was to conduct a little thought experiment. And here's how the thought experiment worked. They said, suppose that there's a lot of social influence going on. Okay. Now, by the way, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a stylized model, which is a model to make the point, which is the model that it's actually the same picture, the same model that they use. But then, obviously, when they go to data, they do something more sophisticated. This is not actually describing the structural model that they estimated. But here's the idea that they wanted to explore. They wanted to explore the idea that social influence can actually create this excess variance. And so here's the model that they used to do it. And once I describe it, you'll immediately see why this has to generate excess variance. It's completely obvious. They said, let's suppose that we have 200 plus one individuals living on a miniature lattice. So this is a linear city, okay? There are three types of people in society, okay? We have type zeros. That's zero stands for no crime. These are the good people amongst us, right? They just are always, they're the people who stand up and say, I'm gonna do the right thing. Then there are the type ones. Type one people are just hardened criminal types. They just can't do the right thing. They're always commit crimes whenever they have an opportunity. Okay? And they're not influenced by anybody either. They just do what they're going to do, and what they're going to do is commit a crime. And then we have the remaining people. So I guess the blues are the good guys, the reds are the bad guys, and the remaining people are influenced by what everybody else does. Okay. And so they set this up in a very simple way in order to make the calculation transparent. They said, suppose in the city that everybody is influenced by the person, that everybody imitates, I guess, yeah, I wrote it here, everybody imitates the neighbor, the imitators, the type twos, imitate the behavior of the neighbor to their left. Okay? So we look here, take a little pointer, here we have a good guy. So who's to the good guys? Here's the person to the right of the good guy. This person is a type 2, imitating the neighbor here on the left. So if this person is going to behave good. Because this person is behaving good, this person is going to behave good, right? Ah, bad guy. Okay. This is an uninfluenceable person. This is a bad guy. What is this person going to do? Right, this is a bad guy. Okay. So you can see how if you get, you know, a good guy, so you're going to get a bunch of good guys. You're going to get a random number of good guys, right? But a whole bunch of them. And then once you have a bad guy, you're going to get a whole bunch of bad guys. You get a random bunch of bad guys, a random number of bad guys, but a whole bunch of them. And so this seems like it should be variance boosting. And you can sit here and do the calculations, and here the calculations are. And the point is that if there were no social interaction at all, if everybody was either a type 0 or a type 1, okay, then if we look at the appropriately scaled, the appropriately scaled sample sums, they would converge to a normal distribution centered. Notice that I centered these sums. You can see that here. So the centered sums would be, their distribution would be converging to a normal distribution with the usual variance, p times 1 minus p, where p in this case is p1 over p0 plus p1. Okay, that's the usual formula, okay? But because of the social interactions, because of this imitation, you actually end up with a larger variance. And this is, by the way, just a straightforward probability calculation, so I'm not going to do it for you. It's a nice statistical problem, and in any event, the reference is in my notes. But what happens is you end up with the variance scaled up. Okay. And the important thing to see here is that we have this parameter pi, which is equal to p0 plus p1. So pi is the probability that an individual is of a committed type, either criminal or good guy, okay, but a committed type. And what you see here is that the higher is pi, the more committed types we have, the smaller the range of influence of any individual is going to be, any committed individual is going to be on average. And therefore, the nearer the variance is going to be to the IID variance, which is sigma squared u. Okay, which remember is what did I say? It's p1 times p0 over p1 plus p0 squared. Right. So the more committed people we have, the smaller this variance is going to be. The fewer committed people we have, the more people who are out there to be influenced, okay, the greater the percentage of the population available to be influenced, the higher the variance we're going to have. All right, so then what happens is that, they went on to actually estimate, they said, okay, we expect to see variance scaled up by some parameter. They went on to build in a statistical model that allowed them to estimate this, and you can see that this number, f of pi, I should go back for a second, this number f of pi, this is the scaling factor that we're interested in, and they looked at a data from a variety of different data sets, and you can see that sometimes these scaling factors are quite large. And they took this to be evidence that there's a lot of social behavior, right? Interactions in individuals driving criminal activity. Now the interesting thing about this, right, is that they didn't estimate a model at the individual level. So if we went back to the previous juvenile crime story, right, they actually had individual level data, right? They had criminal records from the criminal court, and they were looking at the behavior of individuals. Here we're making an inference by saying, look, we've got a model for different parameter values. The model predicts certain aggregate behavior. We're going to estimate off the aggregate behavior rather than off the individual behavior. Okay. All right. So many different ways of skinning the cat, as we say. What's hard about identifying, about finding and measuring these social effects, these peer effects, and other kinds of things? There are several things that are hard about this. Okay, so let's imagine that I'm doing a study of how productive people are in school, what kind of educational outcomes they get, how they're going to do during the year. Here we have two students right here. Okay, and let's congratulations, you're on. You're that place to sit in the front of the room when I'm teaching. Okay, so here's our two guys. Okay, these guys are roommates. Okay, and so the end of the academic year comes, and let's imagine that it wasn't such a good year for either one of you. Okay, and now we want to ask why, right? Is this what is the cause? And suppose you're all coupled up in different ways, and we see that there's a lot of correlation between the members of a couple, right? And maybe it's not just coupled, but some of you are in larger apartments, whatever. But there's a lot of correlation in the grades of individuals living in the same apartment. So let's imagine why. Well, one thing is that these two guys are just bad influences on each other. Or one of these guys is kind of a bad influence and then infected the other guy who is just, one of the follower types, not a P0 or a P1, not a 0 or 1, but a 2. Okay? But here's another thing. It could well be that these guys, who are both pretty hard studying guys, happen to pick an apartment that's right below a club. Right above a club. And that club is open all night long, and there's all this noise coming up, and they just can't study. Okay? That is a shock, which we, the econometricians, would not observe, which is affecting both of them. Right? So that is there's an unobserved shock, and the shock is correlated because it hits them both by virtue of the fact that they're roommates. Okay? Another reason why we might see this kind of correlation of behavior is that he's a party guy. And he wants to live with party guys. This guy over here, he's a party guy. Are you a party guy? You are for the moment. And party guys find each other and live together. Okay? What is that telling us? This is telling us that the network of social interactions is in fact endogenous. We choose our partners. Okay? We choose who our peers are. Okay? So that's the second problem. A third problem is something that I don't want to spend too much time talking about now, that I'm going to talk about later a little bit if there's time, and it's the following. So how might we measure peer effects? Well, we need to have a lot of individual variation, right? And variation in individual behavior. So suppose, for example, that this individual variation becomes, because of the population, is variation in income. And this difference in income, if someone is very rich, they maybe get more investment in education and more help in school, and this lifts their performance, and because other people are trying to keep up with them, that's a peer effect, okay? Right? Because other people are trying to keep up with them, their performance is lifted too, just because they work harder, okay? But another thing that might happen is, and I don't know that this would happen in China, but I'll tell you that it did happen in Israel, where I lived, okay? Is that people in the class actually bought extra teacher time, okay? And so kids got more, the whole class got more instruction because enough parents had enough money to chip in to buy an hour's extra teaching every day, okay? So that income of the parent, right, actually has two effects, right? It has an effect on the kid, right, directly, because they can buy, help out the kid more, and then that has a pure effect, okay? But on the other hand, it's also the case that there's a direct effect of all this extra income directly on other kids, all right? So if you want to measure the pure effect, you've got to entangle those two things, okay? And depending upon the model that you write down, you may or may not be able to do that. And this is an identification problem, which I think turns out to be, it's something that has bothered the literature for many years, since the mid-1990s, but in fact, I think is overblown And by far, we'll talk about it a bit later in my notes, we'll certainly have a lot to say about that. So let's move on. So here's a list of things that I could talk about today. Okay. I'm going to start by talking a bit about network science. So the way that we're going to describe peer-to-peer interactions, the first thing we have to do is we have to say who's interacting with whom, right? And the way that we describe that is by describing networks. So there is a little subject called network science, right, which talks about networks and how to describe them, and I'm going to talk about that. Then I'm going to talk about an application of some social network ideas to labor markets, okay? I'm going to talk something about two applications. Then I'm going to talk about peer effects and complementarity. Maybe I'll talk about games on networks. I've given this lecture 3 or 4 times before. This is as far as I've ever gotten in 3 hours. But what I would really like to do is also talk about network formation. So very often in peer effect models or social interaction models, we take the peer effects to be given, to be exogenous. And we're going to talk a little bit about where networks come from, because we should question, right? Anytime someone says, this is exogenous, your response should be, really? Okay, and that's something that we should be asking about social networks. Did these guys party because they live together and happen to be matched together randomly and influence each other negatively, or are they living together, right? Because they party, they're partier types, right? And that's the endogeneity problem. So we'll talk about that a little bit if there's time. That's only going to happen if I move along. Okay. Questions so far. Okay. So now what I've done is I've given you a little introduction to the kinds of problems that I want to think about, okay, and I've explained a little bit about how this is different from the conventional microeconomics that you have learned, but it's really not all that different because it's really, you know, all the same stuff. And I mean, at the end of the day, you know, at the end of the day, all theoretical models come down to game theory, okay, so we're going to be looking at games. Even general equilibrium models come down to game theory. If you look at never mind. I'd really like to be giving some general equilibrium lectures because that's what I really love. All right. So now I'm going to talk about how to represent pure effects. The way we're going to represent pure effects is by drawing graphs. Now, when I say graphs, you think, okay, I'm going to ask you to plot x squared, like y equals x squared, or something like that. That is not what I mean here. A graph is a mathematical object. Graphs, this is really stupid. I should have had a little picture right here. I'll get drawn this. Steal? Go for it? Okay. Well, we're not going to go very far because all of these are dried up. Okay. So, but you know what? I must have a picture of the next slide or two. Here's a graph. Okay. So you see, what we have here, we have these things called vertices for nodes, right? And then they're connected by lines, and these lines are called edges, okay? And that's what a graph is. A graph is it consists of two parts. Wrong way. So a graph is a pair, where the pair consists first off of a set of vertices or nodes, whatever you want to call them, little dots, okay. And E is a set of edges. And an edge, we're going to talk about two kinds of graphs. We're going to talk about directed graphs. Directed graphs are graphs with arrows. Okay. So if you remember back to the Glaser, Sacerdote, and Checkman paper, we had these arrows. Right, which indicated who is being influenced, who is influencing you. Right, you had an arrow pointing in that direction. That's a directed graph. And we can represent that by saying an edge is a pair. And if we have ordered pairs, then we're talking about a directed graph. We'll say that VW means that there's a connection from VW. If the pairs are unordered, or alternatively, whenever VW is contained in our edge set, so is WV, then we say that the graph is undirected. Okay, and we're going to talk mostly about undirected graphs because they're easier to talk about. Now I'm going to give you the terms of art, right, the language of graph theory, okay, so that when you read some of the articles that are on the reading list or you read other papers that make use of this, you'll just have this terminology somewhere in the back of your head, or at least you can dig out these slides, which will be available, you know, kind of refresh your memory. It's always disappointing to me how much definition you have to get through before you get to real results. So the degree of the node, this is important. So let's imagine we have an undirected graph. The degree of the node is the number of edges that come out of it. Okay? All right? So, and another concept that's important is a path. Okay? So what is a path? Imagine that, I guess you can't see this, but you might imagine that there's a node here, a node here, a node here, and there's an edge from A to B, there's an edge from B to C. So what do we have here? We have a path. We can walk along all these edges to get from A to C, right? So it's an obvious concept, right? A geodesic is a path of shortest length. What's the length of a path? The length of a given path is the number of edges, right, in the path. Okay? And you know, if we think, for example, about cities of the world, some of us came here. Well, Stephen, you actually came here this way, essentially by flying around the world, right? Okay. You have a, Stephen started in Madison, probably flew to Chicago, then you flew to somewhere in Berlin, I guess you did, and then from Berlin to Istanbul to here, okay? And then you're going to fly with a moment to Japan and then back to Chicago. Okay, so that's crazy, by the way. So now we have a path. What I've done is I just described a path where the nodes are the cities that Stephen is going through, right? And the edges are the airline routes, okay? Now they're actually, if we think of that as an undirected graph, right? There are two ways of getting from Guangzhou to Chicago, okay? One way along the is to go in the graph that I've just described, is to fly to Tokyo and then to Chicago. The other way, this is how kind of like how I'm getting home, the other way is to fly back to Istanbul, right, and then fly from Istanbul to Chicago. Since on the graph I said, you gotta go Istanbul to Berlin, to Chicago, to Madison, okay? And those are two different paths and two different lengths, right? So what is the distance in the graph between here and Chicago? The distance is the path of shortest length, which is the one from Tokyo, distance two. Notice that we don't have any notion of how long a particular edge is, okay? We're just counting edges, right? So the fact is, right, is that the edge from Istanbul to here is really long compared to the length of the edge from, here to Tokyo. We're really thinking about things, in terms of geography, but that's not what we're doing. We're just counting edges, okay? A subset of vertices is connected if there's a path between every two vertices, okay? So a line segment, right, like if we think about the Glaser-Sassoon-Chipman line, that is a connected set of vertices because you could traverse the line from any node to any other node, right? There's a path between any two nodes, okay? When we talk about graphs, we can have graphs that are not entirely connected. So you might imagine, for instance, that we have a bunch of people over here who are all connected to each other, and a bunch of people here who are all connected to each other, and nothing in between, right? No links in between. And so this group, we would call this a component. A component is a connected set, which is maximal, which is to say that there's no there are no vertices that are connected to anything in the set that aren't already there, okay? So that's what a component is. And if every single vertex in the component is connected to every other vertex in the component, we call that a clique. Okay. Let's just get to a picture for a moment. So here we have a graph that has three components, right? A, B is a component, C, D, E is a component, and F through M is a component, okay? Right? And this is a clique, actually. It's a trivial clique. This is not a plea, and there are no other pleas, so this is a plea, okay? You can see that E, for example, has degree 2. B and A each have degree 1. Only have one edge coming out of them. H is a really popular fellow over here, right? It's four edges coming out of him or her, okay? So is this clear, right? And if we want to look at the distance between L and H, we can see that there are many paths. You can go from L to H directly, you can go L, M, H, L, K, J, H, you can go all the way around, right? And the distance from L to H is nonetheless 1 because this is the shortest path, right? And I guess we would say that the distance from E to H is infinite because there are no paths. All right, everybody happy? Okay. The diameter of a graph is the maximum. We can look at all the distances from any point on the graph to any other point on the graph, all the distances now. And the longest distance between any two points are called the graph diameter. And I'm now going to describe some things that people spend time measuring. And then we're actually going to look at some data sets where people have measured this. We might also talk about the average distance between points in the graph, right? Another thing to pay attention to is the degree distribution. What percentage of the nodes are of degree 1, of degree 2, of degree 3, right? And what's the mean degree, the average degree? the clustering coefficient. Let's go back. Oops, wrong button. Here we have a path of length 2, okay? And over here we have a path of length 2, LHM, okay? Notice that this path LHM is actually closed off by a line from a link from M back to L, okay? And here there is no such closure, right? So we asked how many of these potential triangles are actually really triangles. So here's a potential triangle that is not a triangle because this is missing. Here is a potential triangle that is really, that really is a triangle because all three edges are there. The percentage of potential triangles that are actual triangles is called the clustering coefficient. What is this supposed to measure? Is it true that the friend of my friend is my friend? Okay. Well, imagine now in a friendship graph. L is a friend of H. And let's see. So the friend M is the friend of my friend L. I'm L. Harry. Okay. M is the friend of my friend Harry. Okay. And therefore he's my friend too. Okay. So this is actually a transitivity property, isn't it? Right. L is a friend to H, H is a friend to M, therefore L is a friend to M, right? And up here, of course, we don't have this transitivity property. So what we're measuring is the degree of something called transitive closure. Another thing we measure is the component size distribution. If you go back to this graph here, we have one component of size 2, one component of size 3, and another component of size 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, okay? And often we want to know things about the component sizes. So let's look. Here is a social network. This is a famous social network. Now I'm going to go to my notes to get all the goods on the social network. Close the network. How come the network only comes up when I don't want it? Okay. All right, so this is a picture which comes from a paper by Peter Behrman, Djibouti, and I don't know, I've never met this soul. It's published in 2004 in the American Sociological Review. And this is in this graph, this is an example of something called a bipartite graph, by the way. You'll notice that there are two kinds of nodes, pink nodes and blue nodes, and the pink nodes are female, the blue nodes are male, okay? And this is this graph represents who dated who, okay? In a particular high school I don't remember where the high school was, although Peter Behrman knows, who dated who, right, over a 6 month period, right, in some American high school, okay? And you'll notice this is kind of an interesting graph, right? There are over the 6 month period, there were 63 couples that were stable, okay? And on the other hand, there were, two close. What's really interesting is this side. And so why do we care about the shape of this graph, okay? The reason that we care about the shape of this graph and what they were thinking about was, well, that, you know, that many of these students are probably having sexual interactions with each other, so we want to think about, for example, the spread of sexually transmitted diseases, okay, among heterosexual couples in this high school. And I call this a bipartite graph because you'll notice that every pink node is connected only to blue nodes, and every blue node is connected only to pink nodes, right? So they did not, either they did not survey or they did not find anyone who admitted to being a same-sex couple. This does come from 2004. And the work was done several years earlier. In any event, this is the kind of graph they found. Now, this kind of graph has a name. Let me move on here. The graph of the kind of result is called the spanning tree. Okay, and you can see that it has a particular property. It looks kind of like a tree or a piece of a tree. Here are other kinds of graphs that you might see, and the kind of graphs that demographers are worried about. So for a moment, look at the glasses so that I can see what I want to say here. By the way, if we go back, I should. That's pretty. One of the things that one has to worry about in doing social network research is if you actually study a particular social network, how do you talk about it? And frankly, people can present tables of numbers saying, here are the moments of the degree distribution and stuff like that. It really doesn't give you the picture. So oftentimes, one tries to get the picture. There's software that will do that. And it's exactly just funding. Okay. In this graph, you'll notice that there are a number of small components. There is one giant connected component, okay, and then a bunch of these little small components, okay. In this giant component, the maximal length, right, the diameter of the graph is 37. And the other thing that's really interesting about this, and that the authors make something of, and you might think about why is this true, there are no force cycles, okay? No one, I don't know how to say this, I have to remember the right way to say this. Yes. No one dates their ex-partner's ex. That's kind of an interesting thing. Let me talk for a moment about why we care about these shapes. So imagine what the epidemiology looks like if we have a graph that looks like this. So this is called the core infection model, right? And what we have here is a small group of people who are very active, and then potentially a lot of other people here who are not really so active, but are connected to the core, okay? And we might imagine this is kind of a cesspool of disease that then kind of spreads out to these less active areas, okay? And if you had an epidemic where there was this core that was coming in, it's hard to think about, you'd have to undertake particular strategies, right, in order to stop the epidemic from spreading. Here we have actually the inverse model where the disease is sitting outside and there's this core of people who are getting battered by outside influences all the time. Okay. Now here, this graph is really rather sparse, right? In that most individuals are actually connected to very few people. Right? So you might imagine here that even though this is a big graph with lots of people connected to each other, because the graft is so sparse, only a few breaks, okay, and the infection stops, right? And so here, what I do is look for key individuals or key loci, right? Where a policy could have an impact. So the point of this is to understand that the shape of a network, what we call the network topology, has impact for the way in which behavior spreads. Suppose that, again, we were thinking about diffusion of a new technology, a new plant variety, or a new way of doing something, right? If the information network looks something like this, we might imagine that social learning isn't really going to spread very far because you get one failure along this long chain and you're kind of done, right? On the other hand, in a model like this, if you get a couple guys in the core going, then it goes everywhere, right? So, and people have studied this kind of thing exactly in this context. Okay. Now, all right, so let's... Okay. This is a pretty picture, but I'm actually not going to talk about it because I want to save time. This is a graph of a friendship network in another high school that comes from in America that comes from a paper by Jim Blume, where the bottom half are, I think, what grade are they? I don't remember. The bottom half are young people, like I think they're sixth graders, and the top half is seventh graders, or maybe it's seventh and eighth, something like this. And then the different colors represent different ethnicities. And the point that Moody was interested in examining was that in the United States, there's been a lot of discussion about diversity in the schools, right? And people having contact, right, with diverse others in the schools. And so we've had court cases and all kinds of things that say that, you know, that indeed schools have to have a diverse population in them, right? And Moody's point was, well, simply to say that the school has a diverse population doesn't mean that schools, that students are actually having a diverse experience, that in fact if students are really stratified and stay within their groups, even though you're in a building with people of many different colors, all of your associations, all of your affiliations are going to largely be with people like you. We haven't accomplished the goal that we set out to do. And then he did a survey of many different high schools doing things like this in order to figure out how percentages of mixing actually determine the degree of stratification. And by degree of stratification, we mean what percentage of greens are connected mostly to other greens, what percentage of yellows are connected mostly to other yellows, and so on and so forth. Okay. So these are examples of the kinds of questions that you can address by looking at a network. Now, a lot of the sociological literature is concerned with what does the network look like. And I'm going to spend a little more time on that, but I think we should remember as economists that what we're often concerned with is not exactly with what the network looks like, but what kind of behaviors does the network support. Okay? And we'll come back to that in just a little bit. So here are some things that networks that have been measured. So these are graphs that one can construct. So film actors, two actors are connected if they have acted together in the same film. This is the famous IMDb data set for those in the back of the room. Company directors, somebody took some large number of United States corporations and then said that two individuals were linked. They sat on the same on the board of directors of the same company. Right? Math co-authorship. Mathematicians were linked if they co-authored together. So in that graph, you might know that there is a guy of maximum degree. Anybody know his name? Pardon? Terry Tao. You're young. Yeah, okay, and, you know, Terry Tao actually might have more co-authors than Paul Erdős, right? You know, mathematicians like to talk about something called their Erdős number, right? How many links am I away in the co-authorship graph from Paul Erdős, right? Stephen is probably three. I have three, right, actually. So you must be at least...
No more than four, then.
So, you know, but you're right that, you know, Terry Tao, right, writes these papers where he organizes people online, right, to prove theorems together, so then he writes a paper with 100 co-authors, right? So, he's an amazing guy, right? So, he might be the leader today. Physics, biology, this is the famous Northern Telecom data set. This is a data set that comes from a month of cell phone calls in London, okay, from a particular mobile phone provider. So one can identify, you know, one can identify the nodes are encoded so you don't know who they are, and we talk to who, and similar things like this, okay? And what's interesting about these things, I think, about these graphs, some people say that this characterizes social networks, and I'm not sure that that's true. People say all kinds of stuff. What seems to be striking in this graph is so what are we measuring? We were measuring the number of nodes, the number of edges, z is the mean degree, and that's a surprising number, right? The mean actor in this very large set of whoever has acted in movies ever, the mean number of actors that you've interacted with is 113. L, distance, the mean geodesic plane, the mean distance, the average distance from one member of the graph to another. And look at this, there's 449,000 people in this data set, and the mean length between them is 3, right? And so these numbers are really rather small, except for student relationships, whatever that is. And I don't remember where that's from. And again, here are the clustering coefficients. These are two different ways of measuring clustering. And that cluster, remember, is the degree of the amount of transit closure that's going on in the graph. It is often said that social networks are characterized by a high degree of clustering, but that doesn't seem to be the case here in these. Okay. So just to compare this with a random construct, a natural random construct. Let me talk about something for a moment called Erdős-Rényi random graphs. That's that same Erdős who, before Terry Tao, was the maximal mathematician. So the idea is that we have a bunch of nodes and we flip a coin to decide whether there's an edge between each pair. Okay? That's an interesting experiment to perform at home and see what they look like. And now what we're going to do is the following. We want to look at large graphs, okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to imagine that we have a sequence of graphs that are constructed by this random coin flipping, okay? And the nth graph is going to have a set of n vertices, okay? And we're going to adjust p as we increase n so that the mean number of people that anybody is connected to is equal to z, okay? So we're gonna set it so that we're gonna shrink the probability down as we let n grow, such that the mean number of people that any individual person is connected to, the mean number of connections is 3, or the mean number of connections is 1/2. Okay, and we want to know as we vary p now, what does this graph actually look like? Okay, and this indicates this picture kind of indicates. A bunch of properties about large graphs, which I think are important. You'll notice that when the number of connections per node is small, when this z is a small number, all the components are small relative to the size of the graph. Right? They all grow. I think they grow at rate something like log n. Okay. The maximal size component, and the distribution of sizes is exponential, and the maximal component grows at rate log n. So as you add more and more n, if the z is say 1/2 or something like that, you're getting a very, very slow growth, right, in the size of the largest component. And then you got all these exponentially tailing off small components. What happens when z crosses 1, when z goes above 1, the structures of the graph tend to change. Now what happens is that when as n gets large, okay, there will be a single component, right, with probability approaching 1 as n goes to infinity, there'll be a single component, okay, which grows linearly, whose size grows linearly with n. So there'll be this large connected component. So if you remember going back to the high school sexual contact or dating graph. If you go back to the dating graph, there was that gigantic component, and then there are all these little pieces, right? And so in that picture, which we can just drop back to for a second, we see that here's the giant connected component, right? And then we have these little small pieces. This is the anything not in the giant component. The remaining components, again, all grow at, you know, the maximal one grows at size log n, and the size distribution is exponential. That's this part, and here's the giant connected component, okay? So this is the kind of behavior, and so the interesting thing about these models is that as the parameter p changes, or z changes, as we go across this threshold, we see qualitative change in the nature of the structure. Now, the really random graphs in many ways don't look very much like the graphs that we were looking at earlier, if you were to compute clustering coefficients and things like this. This has all been done. They don't have the same properties that the other networks do. But this is a, actually what happens here is the clustering coefficient goes to 0 at rate 1 over n. Okay, whatever that's worth. Oops. Why did I do that? Okay, here. There are other random models that have been used to describe social networks. Okay, there's a model that was motivated, and I'm going to tell you just about one. It's called preferential attachment. This was a model by that was motivated by thinking about the way that citations emerge in papers. So we'll say that that A is linked to B if A cites B. Okay. And this would be a directed graph. So you want to know how does this graph grow as we add more and more articles, okay? And one way of doing this is simply, so there's a model. So you might imagine that the most popular papers, right, that are really out there in your field, you write a paper on a topic, you feel you have to cite that paper too, because everybody else cites that paper, right? And then there are these other papers, you know, like my papers that, you know, maybe a few people read, right? And so you might cite them, you might not, right? So the larger, right, the larger the number, so let's think about every day having publishing more articles, writing more articles, okay? And the larger the number, the larger the degree of a given vertex, the larger the number of papers that cite a particular paper, the more likely the next paper written is to cite that paper, okay? All right, so if we imagine that kind of process, right? This is called the preferential attachment model. We can do this randomly. And then what you get, which is interesting in this model, is you get a degree distribution which has a power law tail. It's got a thick tail, okay? And those of you with enough statistics know that power law distributions or thick tail distributions behave very differently than non-thick tail like distributions like normals do. So for example, power law distributions will not have, it will not be the case that all of their moments are finite, right? Which of course is, the normal distribution has all of its moments. Now, what I've just done here is just to describe, very briefly, two kind of random graph processes, ways of discussing graphs. And there's statistical work that's done by both economists, like Aaron Chakar, right, and Matt Jackson, among economists, among many sociologists, that essentially estimate random graph models. They say whatever the process is that generated this particular social network, it was some kind of random graph process. I'll say what it is. There's a class of processes that I'm not going to talk about, but you might want to look up if you're interested in this. They're called exponential random graphs. People estimate these things. Now, to my way of thinking, this actually is not a terribly satisfactory way to go, because I think that if we're looking at graph construction, network construction, these things are in fact social processes themselves. And so we'd like to talk about models of how graphs excuse me, models of what, how networks are put together. And we will be talking about some strategic models right at the end of today's lecture, if I really hurry along, okay? Questions? I'm going to go a little bit farther, and then we're going to take a break, okay? I want to get to the end of the section, and then we'll stop. So I've already mentioned, so now I want to talk about properties of graphs that are important in social phenomena. So here we have the friend of my friend is my friend, right? This is this idea of transitivity. So why is transitivity important? Okay, transitivity is important because of a property of social networks which is called homophily. Now, when I describe a graph, a social network, when I describe a graph, I just said that there are vertices and there are edges, and that's it. Okay, that's the most primitive kind of graph that I can describe. But if you think back to the high school dating graph, right, there is actually more information in there, right, than what I described, because there were actually two distinct kinds of vertices, right? There were pink vertices and blue vertices. You know, there were women and men. Right? So we actually label vertices with properties. Okay. Another thing, by the way, that we can do is we can actually label edges with numbers in order to talk about the strength of the connection between them as well. And these are called weighted graphs. Okay. Why is transitivity important? Well, transitivity is important because one of the things that that seems to characterize social processes is a property called homophily, right? And we'll be talking more about homophily in just a little bit, but homophily is the idea that we tend to connect with people like us. So if we went back to the multicolored graph, you know, the big donut with the circle, the torus, with the green and the red and the yellow, notice that most of the greens were connected to other greens. That yellows were mostly connected to other yellows, and so on and so forth. God bless you. That is an example of homophily. If we have different kinds of individuals in our network, but we think that homophily is at work, okay, then we expect to see high clustering coefficient, okay, we expect to see high coefficients of transitivity. So that's how, coefficients of high clustering coefficients, right? So this is how, social process actually, these social phenomena actually get represented in graphs. Another feature of graphs that we want to talk about is, if we're thinking about, for example, trying to maybe, induce farmers to take up some new technique, okay? Well, one way to do this is to do some, to do some demonstrations, right? And you might imagine the agricultural authorities coming out and setting up a demonstration farm. But of course, they always have more fertilizer than anybody else, and they always get good land. You don't really need them, right? So what you would believe, though, is one of your neighbors actually having luck with this new crop, right? So if you were the agricultural authority and you want to get this thing seeded, right, you want to think about the question, who is the most influential? Who are the most influential people, right? If I want people to learn about this, if I want this new technique or this new variety to take off, right, the best way to do this is to find the most influential people, just give them some of the stuff, have them do it, right, and then demonstrate for everybody how good this new innovation is, and then it'll take off, right? So we'd like to find a way of measuring influence, and one way of doing that is to talk centrality, okay? There are many different definitions of centrality. There's something called degree centrality. The centrality of the node is just the degree of the node, okay? Another notion of centrality is this measure of reach. I skipped over something here. I didn't define this in A. One way of representing a graph and describing a graph is to imagine a matrix, with one row for every individual and one column for every individual. And a 1 in row I, column J, indicates that there is a link from I to J. Right? And if it's an undirected graph, that means there'll also be a link from J to I. That means that there will also be a number 1 in row J, column I. Right? And so that graph has what property? Right? Its transpose is equal to itself, right? Okay. So now, an interesting thing about this is the following: that if you take this matrix has a name. It's called the adjacency matrix, right? And if you multiply the adjacency matrix by itself, think about the formula for A squared ij. It's the sum over k of aik times akj, right? So akj is going to be equal to either 1 or 0, and it's going to be equal to 1 when both aik and akj are equal to 1. In other words, if there's a path of length 2, right? So a squared, the elements of the matrix a squared actually count the number of paths of length 2. The number of the elements of a cubed actually count, the elements of a cubed actually count the number of paths of length 3, and so on and so forth, right? So what is this? This thing by this guy Katz is actually a discounted sum. That's good for us. Kind of a slight discount, right? So, a discounted sum of the number of paths of length k from I to j discounted by this factor alpha, right? And so this is, I forgot, well, this is CI of alpha. There's a name for it. I don't remember what the name is, but it's been used in the literature, okay? More important notion of centrality, the one that seems to get us the most excited, is something called eigenvector centrality. Okay, here's a description of it. So, I am central if I influence a lot of central people. Okay. All right. So, what I could do is I want to find I want to assign a set of weights that measure centrality to every individual, right? And then I want my weight, and then I want the weight of any one individual to be the weighted sum of the centrality measures of everybody that person influences. Is that clear? Okay. So if you actually write that out mathematically, what you want is you want this vector of weights to be a left eigenvector, okay, of this adjacency matrix. Okay? This is sometimes called Banach centrality, okay? The matrices that we're talking about are non-negative matrices, and you all know that there is a nice theory of non-negative square matrices. You might have heard of something called the Perron-Frobenius theorem. And the Perron-Frobenius theorem tells us that there is a maximal eigenvalue, right, which will be real. Okay, eigenvalues can be complex numbers, but the eigenvalue of maximum modulus will be real. Okay, maximum size, right, will be real, and the eigenvector. Will be, there's some other properties that the matrix has to have that I'm skipping over. You can look this up, okay? They'll typically be 1, okay? If the matrix is connected and if it's not a periodic matrix, this maximal eigenvector will be uniquely defined up the scale, okay? And therefore, and so that gives us our centrality measure. So why is this an important idea? How many of you use search engines? Only one of you uses a search engine? You're the only person in the room who's ever used a search engine? Who knows what a search engine is? How many of you fire up your browser and you type something in? You want to find a restaurant or a movie, or read a review, something? How many of you don't do this? Well, all right, what search engine do you use? How do you get Google? We have to talk. driving since I've been here, right? And also that Microsoft thing, Bing, right? Okay, and so if you're using these, you'll notice, right, that you type in a keyword, right, and or a key phrase, and it comes back with a listing. How does it decide? Right, it's using, and what is PageRank? PageRank is a way of associating with every keyword, right, a keyword, a set of it ranks, right, different websites that are most closely affiliated with these keywords, right? And how does it do it? Okay, what is it doing? What is the PageRank algorithm, right? It's actually looking at the network, right, of websites that are associated with that keyword, and it's computing, right, the eigenvector centrality, and then giving you back those things in order. Okay, that's what the PageRank algorithm actually does, right? Okay, so there you have it, right? Centrality, we live it every day, okay? So centrality is obviously very important in a social sense, as I mentioned. We want to know who's most influential. And there are multiple ways of measuring it, and it's worth noting that you get different answers, of course, depending upon which measure you use. While many people, many economists in particular, are very attracted to things like eigenvector or Bondi centrality, this is something that, you know, that one might actually think about in the context of the model. When I want to talk about centrality, what is it that I really want to measure, right? And if I want to, you know, there are different ways, and I want to think about, well, if I want to measure influence, what do I mean by influence? And that's going to determine what kind of centrality measurement All right, so what I want to do now is stop for really no more than 10 minutes, okay? And then we will come back and we will talk about some other stuff. So I want to talk a little bit about homophily. This is something that I stole from Stephen. Okay. He's my Aristotle man. Plato, of course, said it much quicker, much more pithy. Similarity begets friendship. And I've already indicated, we've already seen some pictures that show that, you know, that that people of similar type tend to live together. This is a picture, many of you won't know this, but this is a beautiful, this is a picture of Chicago, city of Chicago. And what this mapmaker did was to look at groups of 20 houses and then put a dot whose color was coded for the ethnic group that is most highly represented, the modal ethnic group that was in among the 20 households. And what you can see, so this is something, this construction is called a dot map. And this is a largely African American population down here. The pink is Caucasian population. Yellow is Hispanic, and gray is industrial zone, and you can see kind of a sharp. You can see a lot of clustering, of course. And the other thing that you can see more if you examine this in greater detail, you can see that these boundaries are. It's interesting that a lot of these boundaries down here are really sharp. Up here, you see that the boundaries are a little bit. This is Northern Chicago, Northwestern University is right there. University of Chicago, is that, I don't know how far down there is, but it says South Chicago is not
the purple part,
the purple,
and
the
blue.
Yeah,
the purple
over to the
spot right. Down there?
Up.
Here.
That
there
cluster.
You go.
That's High Park. There it is. Okay. This is home to us, right?
Great Lord.
That's the gym. Homophily is an interesting issue in its own right. If we actually care about diversity as a thing on sich, as a thing in itself, and it also is something that creates problems for us when we want to study actions on networks. And let me move. So, what are the sources of homophily? There are, I think, three sources of homophily, Oops, where did that go? Back up. I guess the first people to write a lot about Homopoly were Paul Lassersfeld and Robert Burton? What's Burton's first name? You got to remember. Burton, the sociologist, father of the finance guy. You know? Famous sociologist.
Yeah, it was his first name.
One of the inventors of rational expectations.
Robert King.
Pardon?
Robert King.
I can't hear you.
Robert Kamer?
Yes, Robert K. Right. Okay. And so here's a paper, by the way, on rational expectations in the Antioch Review in the 1940s. I think it's really cool. So in any event, they wrote, Burton and Lassersfeld wrote about status and value homopoly. Status homopoly is that we feel more comfortable when we interact with others who share a similar cultural background. Value homopoly, we often feel justified in our opinions when we're surrounded by others who share the same beliefs. One thing I think that is worth thinking about, when you know, it's wonderful to read sociologists and social psychologists when they talk about all this stuff, and they have this very rich vocabulary, right, and they describe all this kind of stuff. And now we want to kind of get this stuff into our economic models. And ultimately, typically what we want to do is we want to understand decision making either about a network or by people who are networked together. And if you think about it, our decision models are really rather parsimonious. They're rather, they don't take a lot to describe. You have tastes, you have beliefs, okay? You have constraints. That's the whole thing. And so it is worthwhile thinking about, well, we have all this rich talk from all these other social scientists. How do we encode these in our stripped down models in ways that we can actually use them? And this is a thing we should be aware of. There is a third kind of homopoly that Lassersfeld and Burton didn't write about, and that's what I call here opportunity homopoly. And that is that in the course of our lives, we tend to mostly run into people. We don't have that many opportunities to interact and therefore create social relationships with people who are extremely different. So we have some, of course, but you spend most of your time in university. Not surprisingly, most of the people you meet are university students like yourselves, right? So mere opportunity to some degree determines who it is that we see. Now, I want to talk about the problems that homopoly can create for doing social science. This is a graph from a famous study that was undertaken by Nicholas Christakis and James Pollard, and this has to do with obesity. And let's see if I can get this right. I'm going to have to actually look at my notes to get this right. This graph encodes a lot of data. This data comes from a town outside of Boston in Massachusetts. These guys wanted to study obesity. And they wrote some very well-known papers where they claim that obesity is contagious in social networks. You're nodding. Have you heard of this work? I mean, some people have, right? It's created a buzz for a little while. And in this graph, the size of a given dot, and it's hard to see the glare, but the size of a given dot, each node represents a single person in the data set. The size is proportional to that person's body mass index, which is a measure of relative obesity. Okay, it's weight divided by the square of your height or something like that. Yellow dots are people who officially satisfy the medical definition of being obese. Red rim dots are female, and it's really hard to see the red. And white rim dots are male, or non-red rim dots are male. Purple lines represent genetic links. Other colored lines, and I can't really tell where they are, represent friendship links. And what they did was they studied this network over a number of years. This is a picture from one of the years. And these guys came to the conclusion that if you have fat friends, if you have obese friends, you are likely to become obese. Okay. Now, I want to say first that this kind of seems not really plausible, right? That obesity would be contagious. You can catch obesity like you can catch a cold, right? All right. And in fact, this work was very carefully, surgically taken apart by a student of Stevens, Ethan Cohen Cole, and a co-author whose name I have here, by the way. Fletcher. Wasn't you? We won't talk about it. So what is really the issue here? The issue here is pretty clear, I think. You could entertain the hypothesis, right, that individuals become in fact there is this social influence. If you're with a bunch of people who are, you know, large, then you don't worry about your own weight so much. And maybe you hang out with these people and they don't exercise a lot, so you don't exercise a lot, and maybe causation goes that way. Of course, on the other hand, you could imagine that because of your size, you tend to look for people who are sized as you are, okay? And so the causal arrow can go the other way, right? And untangling this is a difficult thing to do, okay? And so this is one of the effects of homophily. The issue here is that the network is not static. The network is changing, okay? And your behaviors are also changing. And what we want to think about here is the time scale at which the network changes relative to the time scale at which your behavior changes. Okay? If the network is changing faster than your behavior, right, in some sense, then we really have to think about the network as being endogenously determined and have to kind of proceed in one direction. Okay. On the other hand, if the network is changing slowly, relative to the behaviors in which we're studying, if it's changing slow enough, we may be able to take the network as exogenous, nearly so, and that would suggest a different set of statistical procedures. Okay. And what those procedures are, you can ask the experts in the back of the room. You don't ask a theorist those questions. This is a case, I think, where endogeneity of the network, this is where homophily plays a role in trying to sort this kind of thing out. This is a nice example of how you can go wrong in an interesting way. And I'm not going to skip ahead. I want to talk about small worlds. Okay. So there was a famous article that was published in a non-refereed journal called Psychology Today. And it was published, I think, in 1967. Okay. It was written by a guy named Stanley Milgram, who's a well-known and somewhat suspect social psychologist. What he did there's an old idea, right? An old idea is that the world is really very tightly connected. It's pretty easy to reach. The social distance in the world social network, the distance from you to anybody else is really kind of small. This is what he wanted to investigate. So there was a play that was written in the United States by a guy named John Warr in 1990. It was called 6 Degrees of Separation. The idea is that the mean distance between any two people, or maybe even something like the 90th percentile distance is 6. Okay. 6 becomes the magic number. This, in fact, actually is an old idea. There's a short story written in the 1920s by a Hungarian guy named Friedrich Karinthy. Actually, it would be Karinthy Friedrich, right? And it's called Chains. And he has a bunch of people sitting around talking about, well, how easy is it to reach anybody else? And the number there is 5. This was in 1920 something when he wrote this story. This is a very old idea. And Milgram decided to investigate this. And so what he did was to find some people in Nebraska, and he gave them letters. And he said, I want you to send this letter to a friend of yours with the ultimate goal of getting it to a target person in Massachusetts. So you might send a letter to your friend of yours in Massachusetts, and then that person might send it to the right town, and then someone in the town might know, okay, well, this guy's a lawyer, I know some lawyers, so I'll send it to the lawyer, and then gradually gets to this guy. Okay? And then, Milgram did this, okay, and then looked at all the letters that came in, okay, and saw that the mean degree, the mean length, mean number of intermediaries, was 5.2. Okay? So the idea is somehow that that the world is small. That's what this experiment purports to show, that the world is small, that the social distance from anybody to anybody else is tiny. Okay? Now, this fact is in fact, I think, a pseudo fact. Other people have tried to replicate this. It turned out that Milgram took socially very similar individuals at both ends. Right? And when someone tried to do this with having, I think somewhat wealthy people in Boston and poor people in Los Angeles, none of the chains completed. Okay. And so perhaps this is evidence of stratification more than anybody else. Moreover, someone had actually found his research notes discovered that he was highly selective in what he wrote. This is not a piece of research, so you should not rely on it. But it is an important idea. There is a belief which is borne out in some other data sets that have been analyzed more carefully, that path lengths in social networks are small relative to the number of people who participate in them and the number of edges in the network. Right? Obviously, if you get really small path lengths, then you just have lots and lots of edges, right? If you have the complete graph, right, if the graph is one big click, right, then the mean and the maximal and the minimal path length is one, okay, between anybody. But how do you get a small mean path length with a large number of nodes and not too many edges? And so here's an idea that is known as the Watt-Strogatz model. A way of generating short path lengths. So here I have a bunch of people that are connected up to each other in the circle. So I don't know how many points I have, but it's a pretty far distance from one end of the circle to the other. Now here's the idea. Suppose that we take one of these links and we break that link, and then we hook it up to somebody else at random. Okay, so that's what I've done here. I've broken the blue link and I replaced it with a red link. Well, now what I've done actually is I have shortened a lot of path lengths. So for these two guys, for instance, it's now much quicker to get over here than it was before when you had to go all the way around one to the other. So I really shrunk the mean path length, right? I do it a second time, and again, more path lengths have shrunk, okay? Because there are ways of cutting across the circle. And the idea here, and this is provable, that when you do this, you get very short path lengths, very short mean geodesics very quickly. This idea connects with another important idea, the next idea that I want to take up, which has to do with different kinds of ties in networks. Okay? So you might imagine that that these people who are connected up to each other, that these people nearby, let's imagine here that nearby people, okay, are similar to each other, okay? But maybe the people living on this side of the graph are really different from the people living over here. But everybody's pretty similar to their neighbor, right? So you might imagine, for example, a color which gradually shades from, say, green to, yellow, and then back to green as we go around. Okay, so everybody's neighbors are pretty near to them in color, but one side of the graph is really green, the other side is really yellow. Okay, most people are linked to people who are very, very close to them. We have a few people, okay, who link to people who are very different from them. Okay, and the effect of those people who link to very different, so we have a graph that's characterized by a lot of homophily. Okay, and then we have a few people who are linked to people, to just maybe one person who's very different than they are, and that has the effect of dramatically shortening the graph, making transmission of knowledge, making all kinds of transmission of disease as well, suddenly much, much quicker. Okay, So now the next question to ask is, well, what is the difference between the black ties and the red ties? Okay. So we might imagine that the social content of black tie graphs and black tie edges and red tie edges are different, right? So you might imagine that black edges correspond to people who you work with, or maybe family members, people like this, and they're going to be pretty similar to you. And on the other hand, a red tie might be someone who you see very casually, okay, or very occasionally. You go to a given coffee house or a tea house, and there's a guy at the next table who's there regularly, and you kind of strike up a conversation with him from time to time, and you don't really know him, but you kind of know him, right? We all have these people that we see kind of more or less every day, and sometimes you nod and say hello, and that's it. Or they might be people that you worked with a long time ago, or you went to school with, and that they grew up with, and then they drifted off and did something totally different. Okay? Sociologists, starting actually with a guy named Mark Brandenburg, characterized these ties by saying that these are strong, okay, and these are weak, okay? And the object of the point here is that a lot of the action in this network happens because of the presence of weak ties. I want to talk about the implications of this for labor markets. Okay? We might as well do a little bit of economics. Okay, so let me move ahead. We're going to skip that. So here's my second empirical slide. Okay, here it is. So this is a chart from a paper by James Montgomery, a colleague of Stevens. Is he part-time? He's in economics as well as sociology, or what?
All sociology.
With that econ PhD. What a lonely fellow. and this is from a paper that, even though he's sitting in the sociology department, he wasn't in the economics department when he published this. Right? This is you recognize the type. This is from the AER, right? The American Economic Review. And this here actually is just a survey of studies, a number of studies that have been done, starting with this famous Myers and Schultz study in 51 and going up to 1980. How do people find jobs, right? Friends and relatives, you apply right at the factory door. If you're applying for a factory job, you go through an employment agency, you answer an ad, or is there some other weird way? Okay, and what you notice here is that as opposed to just kind of applying randomly to jobs, or going through an employment agency or responding to advertisements, right? Most jobs of this kind, most of the action here is with friends and relatives, okay? So it seems, again, that social connections of some kind is important for job search, all right? And so I want to talk a little bit about that. Now the first person that, as I mentioned, to really kind of investigate this carefully is a fellow named Mark Brandenburg, who is a sociologist still at Stanford. And this actually was his job market work, his thesis in his job market paper, which he published in 1973. And he wants to think about there being strong ties and weak ties, and maybe ties in between as well. And what does he mean by a strong versus a weak tie? Well, the strength of a tie is some kind of combination of the amount of time, the intensity, the intimacy, the investment, et cetera, et cetera, the services, you know, how often do you do for me, do I do for you, that characterize the tie. And then he wants to think about what he does is he goes out and he surveys people. I believe the people were in Newton, Massachusetts, who had found jobs, I don't have to say, okay, in some amount of time. And what he discovered was that, he looked at people who were a sample of managerial and professional people who had just changed jobs in Newton, Massachusetts. It's a wealthy suburb of Boston, an upper middle class suburb of Boston over some period of time. He asked the people who found a new job, how did they find the job, and if they got it through a contact, how often, how did they connect to that contact?
How often do they see them? So he decided to operationalize strength by saying, well, how often do you run into this person? And then he also asked the informant, the person, if I found a job and I got it from you, he would then call up you and say, well, where did you hear about this job from? And then trace that down, all the way down. You heard it from him, he called you up, okay? So what did Brad Hunter find? He found that the typical informant, well, here's the distribution. He said that when he asked people how often they saw the person who told them about the job, only 16% said often. Most of the people, over half, said only occasionally, and 27%, right, said rarely. Okay. So most of the jobs weren't coming from people you see all the time, right? They were coming from people who you were socially more distant from. Okay. Now this actually makes sense if you think about it, because I might be talking to the people in the front row all the time, and the people in the back row I don't talk to very much at all. But you know, so you're close to me, and the people who are close to you are also close to me. So if I sample you guys, I'm not getting a lot of new information, right? But when I sample some guy in the back of the room, right, this person very far away from me, his information sources are very different. Even though there is less information, it's very likely to be more valuable. Okay? And this was at least part of Grant Evans' intuition. Okay. So there's a lot of data that says this kind of thing goes on. There's a study in Russia in 2005 that does that. In a couple of minutes, I'll talk a little bit about a study that was done. I will just mention that there is a study that was done in China by one of my, I think one of my, the people that I most like to read on this topic. I'll give you a citation for that. Okay, so let me explain. Here's kind of a little theoretical model that a friend of mine dreamed up. Why you might imagine that weak ties are going to be very important. So here we have two groups that are very tightly connected. Okay, you'll notice in fact that they're cliques. Okay, so why are they cliques? They're cliques because they're characterized by the property of triadic closure, right? That every potential triangle is in fact closed. And so that makes them very densely connected. In this case, it turns them into cliques, okay? So now let's add a tie between A and B. So this tie that I've added in red is now a bridge between these two cliques and it connects them. If this bridge is cut, we're back to having, if we cut it, we're back to two components, okay? So this bridge plays a very important role in information flow, right, coming across, right, from one group to the other. Now, you know, it's very rare that we're going to have two clusters connected by only one person, so we might imagine a situation where we have more than a few, you know, maybe a few links like this. And we're going to call these things local bridges. And they're local bridges because the endpoints of any bridge, in this case here, A and B, they don't have any friends in common. And here, what I should have labeled C and D, don't have any friends in common. So we'll call that situation a local bridge. Okay. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to label these edges with types. Okay. Some of these are S's for strong ties. Some of these are weak ties. Okay, here's a natural property of strong ties. Okay, what I want to say is that I'm going to oppose what I call the triadic closure property, which says that if a length two path contains only strong edges, then that triad is in fact closed with some kind of edge. Okay, so here we have So here we have an S and an S, right, and it's closed with a W. Here we have an S and an S, and it's closed with an S. All right. So every triad, every potential triangle that has two strong edges has some kind of edge, strong or weak for the third side. Right? Okay, so when we impose that property, what does this say? It says that any local bridge that is connected to a node having another tie which is strong is going to have to be a weak tie, right? If this were strong and this is strong, then there'd have to be a connection between A and B, okay? So what does this say? If we think that strong ties are tight enough that friends of friends are at least weakly connected, okay, then the only kinds of ways that you can bridge from one link to the next is through weak ties, okay? And so this indicates why, roughly, why weak ties can be a very, very important thing. It's likely that weak ties are going to be information carriers. Now, this is not a deep model of any kind, okay? But it is really suggestive. I think, you know, the idea that says that strong ties should have lots of triadic closure, okay? And weak ties less so, means that weak ties are going to play more of this bridging role. And this bridging role is what makes them so useful for things like job search. Okay. Another point, by the way, the grant that are made about weak ties is that you have to invest less in them. So let's think about the person that you see that you run into in the coffee house or the tea house, right? You sit down and he's there and you have a conversation with him, and if not, right? But you don't call each other up and all that. On the other hand, think about how you are with a very good friend. You know, sometimes you don't need to talk with this friend. They just don't want to see this person for a while. But you know, they're going to get very upset, okay? I haven't seen them in a place, so I have to take them out to dinner, right? And then, we invest in these things, right? And it's a lot of work, right? And think about, all the work we do with our family and our siblings and all that, and how much, and you're all surprised at how many of you had siblings, right? So, strong ties require investment. Weak ties don't really require so much. So weak ties, A, bring us new information, and B, are less costly to maintain, right? And so this makes them very economically advantageous. And now what I want to do is I want to talk a little bit about how ties and in labor search how social structure can actually influence wages in the labor market. Okay? So now what I'm going to do is I don't want to build a model that's complicated enough to have strong and weak ties. So what I'm going to do is talk about a model with one kind of tie. But what I want to do is build a model that will demonstrate to you how social structure has an impact on wage setting in the labor market. Okay? So this is the model that is due to Jim Montgomery in that paper. It has a nice chart. And so this is a little theoretical model. It might have been the last theoretical paper ever published in the AER. Here's the model. Workers live for two periods, same number of workers in both periods. Okay? Half the workers are high ability workers, right? And the other half are low ability workers. And workers, it doesn't matter, workers will know their type. Workers do know their type. It actually doesn't matter, I'm sorry. Workers know their type, but firms don't know their type, okay? And a firm doesn't have any information. It hires a worker, maybe a productive worker, maybe it's not a productive worker. All right. Each firm is going to employ one worker, and profits are going to be equal to employee productivity, which is either 0 or 1, right, minus the wage rate. We're going to assume that there's free entry of firms into this market, which basically means that expected profits are going to be 0. It doesn't mean that until I also say that firms are risk neutral, okay, and care about expected profits. It's not obvious, by the way, why firms should care about expected profits. Despite what you may have been told in your intermediate micro class, it's not obvious why that's the right decision criteria for firms, but we're going to assume that it is. So the equilibrium condition is that firms' expected profits are 0. This means that wage offers are going to be expected worker productivity. Okay. So now just imagine, suppose we have only one period, let's simplify it a lot. We have only one period we're going to hire a worker. What's the wage rate going to be in the market? half of the workers earn zero, half of the workers earn one. The wage rate has to equal the expected, has to equal the expected revenue, the expected product. So what's the wage rate going to be? Right, it's going to be one half, 0.5, right? Okay, so you guys are already there. All right, so now, now we're going to make the model a little more complicated. Okay, so if we had no social structure at all, we have this generation, and then we have another generation, okay, our wage rate would be one half of period one, one half of period two, and that would be it. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to suppose that every period one worker knows at most, maybe he does, maybe he doesn't, but he knows at most one period two worker. Okay, and each so the way I'm going to set this up is that each period one worker has a social tie with probability tau. Okay, and I think I thought about it, Jim wasn't careful about this in the paper. I thought about the only way that you could implement this is to actually connect every worker up with an with every type one worker up with a unique type two worker, and then flip the coin to decide whether that edge is really there. Okay, that would be the way to do it. So it's not anonymous. But that's fine, it doesn't matter to the story. It's your child, okay? So every type one worker knows at most one type two worker. And some workers don't know any type two workers. The probability that a given worker of period one knows a worker of period two is tau. Right? So that's gonna be an important parameter for us. That's gonna be the measure, the network density. If tau is near one, nearly every type one worker, period one worker rather, knows a period two worker. Every young worker, every old worker knows a young worker, okay? If tau is very low, near zero, most old workers don't know any young workers, okay? And so that's gonna be one parameter. The other parameter, which I refer to here as inbreeding bias, says the following. Suppose that I have a tie. It's gonna be more likely, okay, that person is like me than not like me. So if I'm a productive person, it's going to be more likely that that person is productive. If I'm unproductive, it's going to be less likely that that person is productive, okay? Alpha is going to measure how much likely that is, right? If alpha is equal to one half, it's just random, okay? And I don't know, and if alpha is greater than one half, okay, then if alpha is very near one, then it's likely that anybody that I know is as productive as I am. Okay. Now here's how the model actually works, and we'll have to see why the social structure is important. All right. So we're going to have in period one, we're going to have the typical anonymous wage market, wage labor market, the typical labor market the wages are going to clear. Wages are going to be set to clear the market at some wage, which we call WM1 for the first period market wage. Then there's production, okay? And at the end of this period, every firm knows how productive its worker actually was. Did I get a one or did I get a zero? Okay? Now, time for the second period. So here's the thing. The old worker, now at the end of his life and ready to retire after one period, it's like an insect, says, aha, I know this young worker and I recommend him to you. Okay? Okay? And now you have, right, and so now you have a choice, okay? You can hire this guy at some wage, okay? Or you can dip into the second period anonymous labor market, all right? So what the firm is going to do, the way we're going to run this down, is we're going to have the firm, knowing how productive his worker is, he's going to set a referral offer for the second period. So what he'll say is, if you refer me someone to me, okay, then I will hire him at wage WRF, okay? All right. Then once we've done that, then it doesn't matter when we do the social tie, but now the social ties become visible, okay? And period one workers now who are matched to somebody, remember some period one workers are not matched, but those who are, recommend their worker. Okay. Period. Okay. Now we go to period two workers who got a referral offer have to decide whether or not to enter the market. Right. They can either accept the offer that they've got, or they can go into the anonymous labor market. Those workers, and I didn't put this down here, but those workers who did not know anybody,
in period two. They have no choice but to go into the anonymous bucket. Okay? So then we have our, after the referral business clears, we have our anonymous market and period two market clears at a wage rate WM2 for the second period market rate, and then production occurs and we're all done. Okay? Well, that's kind of the point. Well, it's not adverse. Well, maybe it is adverse. Let's see what it is. Yeah, but it is certainly going to be the case that there's selection stuff going on here, right? You might imagine, you know, it doesn't take a lot of economic intuition, or maybe it only takes economic intuition and no tenant or skill at all. That might be the better way to say it. It's going to be pretty clear that a firm is going to treat the recommendation of an unproductive worker differently than he's going to treat the recommendation of a productive worker, right? And so we'll see that. So let's turn, you know, this is not, there's only one thing in this model that is hard to work out, okay? So the first fact, and this should be obvious, is that only firms with productive workers are going to make a referral offer to whoever is recommended. Okay? But I got an unproductive worker, it's going to turn out that I would rather dip into the anonymous market. Okay? And it's a simple calculation to see that. Here's the one fact that you actually have to know some microeconomics to do. In this model, there's a little bit of market power. Okay? And that market power is that a given type 2 individual, the way that Jim wrote this down, might actually have more than one referral offer. All right? It might well be that, you and I are young workers and these two guys are old guys and they both know you and no one knows me. So they actually both recommend you. It's not that you choose the better offer. Okay? In the meantime, I'm going into the anonymous market. Okay? So there is some market power, and because of that market power, it turns out that referral wages are in fact kind of randomly distributed on some interval. Okay? And there's a nice discussion of that in the paper. This is an outgrowth of some stuff that people used to get interested in back in the 70s about what can you get price dispersion in an asymmetric market. All right, here's the next fact. This should be clear. the second period market wage rate should be less than one half. Let's think about why that should be true. Who is going to be in the second period? In the second period market, it's going to be people who didn't know anybody, okay? And those people who didn't know anybody are, 50-50, right? Good or bad workers. And it's also going to be people who know unproductive people, right? And they are more likely to be unproductive, right? So the mix in the labor market is more unproductive than productive, right? And so the second period wage rate should fall. Okay. Second period profits are going to be positive. Okay. Now, but you should have zero profits overall. Okay. And the way that's going to happen is that the market wage rate in the first period is going to be greater than one half. Okay. Now, why is it going to be greater than one half? What's the intuition behind that? Okay. This is an interesting, it's a simple idea. Say it so we all can hear it.
I mean, more information to see?
Yeah, there's more information. Someone is worth not just right their productivity, but also the information that they have, right? So if I'm an unproductive worker, I am worth zero, and the value of my referral to you is zero. But if I'm a productive worker, okay, the value of me to you is A, my output, which is one, and also the fact that I'm more likely than not to give you a productive worker in the second period, okay, where you will earn positive profits. Okay? So there's an information rent, okay, which drives the wage rate up greater than one half. Okay? So you can already see here how the effect of social structure is apparent, right, in the model. The simple model had one half, right? When there was no social structure at all. Once we have social structure, it has this
distorting is the word. Well, it isn't. You know, it has this perturbation effect on the market wages. Okay. First period wages grow up. Second period wages in the market go down. Or the unemployment. By the way, the total wage bill actually goes down. Okay. And that's why in the second period, the total wage bill in the first period is in the second period when there's no social structure is 1/2 times the number of workers. Now it actually goes down. Okay. Okay. So here's the comparative statics of the model. As we increase alpha, we're increasing the inbreeding bias. We're increasing the degree of homophily, right? The degree to which the person who I'm connected to is like me. And then the other thing we're doing is we're increasing the likelihood of there being a tie, right? The likelihood of there, you know, that we're making the social structure more dense as we increase tau. And the effect of these is to, as we do increase either one of these parameters, is to lower the second period market wage, to increase the first period market wage, to increase second period profits for the firm. And the other thing is, this is the lower bound wage of a wage distribution for the referrals in the second period, okay? And that's actually going up, okay? Because the referrals are now more valuable as we increase, say, alpha, because the referrals are more sure who they are, okay? So this is a nice model in that it has a very simple social structure. Okay, and now we can see how it actually is reflected in market wages. Now, I think that it's a fun exercise to think about how you might enrich this model. You might want to tell more of a dynamic story and have some overlapping generations and things like this. You could talk about persistence in some interesting ways. There's a lot of fun things one can do. I don't think that they're first order fun things to do, though. So it's kind of like you want a nice theory exercise to work on for a couple of weeks. It's fun to do this. I'm not sure if there's a thesis. Okay, but I think that this makes some very nice points. Okay, and I am nearly, I have like 25 minutes left. This says everything I've already said. Okay, I'll let you read that for a second while I drink this life-giving tea. All right, and moving on. So here's a paper that I discovered just recently, and I haven't really integrated it into my notes. But Nan Lin is a sociologist. He is at Duke or UNC? UNC. No, I think that's right. And I met him at a conference in Italy several years ago, now about 5 or 6 years now, more like 10. I spent actually several days with him in northern Italy, and I learned a lot. I think he has a very interesting take on social networks and social capital. Right? Social capital is this, to use the term of art in economics, it's a real bullshit concept. Nobody knows exactly what they're talking about when they talk about social capital. I have a slide coming up which talks about all the different definitions that people use and what's wrong with them. So Nan Lin actually has a very clear definition of social capital, having to do with the resources that are embedded in social networks and that are able to be activated by individuals because of their location in the network. That's something that I can imagine operationalizing and using. Right? So he's a very interesting guy. And while I've been talking here, you've had a chance to read this piece of his abstract, okay? So that you can see what they found. So what they had access to a data set that evidently I have a little more information on it here. So the idea here was to take advantage of a big natural experiment called the economic transformation of China. Okay. Any identification problems yet? So what he wanted to understand was how changes in institutional arrangements affect the job search. I guess there were several studies before which you talked about in the paper that disagree on everything. Not surprising. So what he wanted to do was to kind of structure the results that were out there and structure some of his own empirical results, their own empirical work, Felicia John, by making use of strong and weak ties, and the strength of weak ties hypothesis, namely that weak ties are very useful. And what I find most interesting about this, I'm sure you probably have different views on what's most interesting, but I thought it was most interesting that that as we went through this transformation, strong ties became more important, which is to say nepotism became more important for finding jobs in the state. Okay? Whereas weak ties all what happened was that all social ties became more important. And weak ties became, more important for finding all kinds of jobs, but the private labor market didn't use weak ties so much as the state labor market did. Okay. Didn't use strong ties so much as the state labor market did, right? So this, this has a lot of interesting implications, I think, which you can imagine better than I, and so I'm going to leave you to do that on your own while we move on. So this is a very nice paper, and it was actually, as you can see, it was just published earlier this year, which is why I just got added to my notes. Yes, and I can't talk too much about this, but I don't know that much about it, yes. I think that he asked people some questions. They had a survey. There was a survey instrument. It was a standard survey instrument. Okay, that they use. And I think that strong ties were family. Okay. And he did something clever about friends, but I don't remember what it was. Okay, he could not do the kind of more fine-grained thing that Mark Granovetter did, where he actually asked, "What's the nature? How often do you see me? What do we do together?" That kind of thing. So I'm going to send you the paper for more details. Okay, I really actually came across this paper just before I left to come to Europe, and I was kept pretty busy, but I was in Vienna, so I didn't have time to really. But I wanted to call it to your attention because I think that he's a very interesting guy, and I think that the finding is provocative. And when I my quick scan of the paper, I thought it was interesting. So, but you don't tell me. Okay, after dinner. all right. So let's move on. We're going to not talk about this model. I really don't think it's a very interesting model. Okay, maybe so much more that I want to talk about. All right. I don't want to talk about this either. This is work actually that I'm going through that Stephen and I have done together with several different co-authors, and I would encourage you to look at this part of the slides, but I only have 20 minutes. And I'm around all week, and so you can ask me questions about this, but I think it's more fun to talk about other stuff. What I want to talk about is, the last thing I want to talk about is where do networks come from? And we wanted to talk about earlier on, I described one mechanism for network generation, which is to say just random graphs. You just imagine that out of the air, out of an urn, it's got to be a big urn because it holds a lot of networks, and you reach in and you pull out a network and there it is, right? And so we have different ways of describing probability distributions on networks, okay? The Bernoulli random graph, exponential random graphs, so on and so on. Okay, so another way to do this is to think about how networks are actually constructed, okay? Now, before I actually talk about a model of this, I want to say that the domain of this research is fascinating because it has a lot to do. We can use this research in two ways. One way in which we can use this research stream is to talk about networks that we observe in the world and think about where they might have come from and how they might have been put together. All right? Or if you want to, and this is something that Stephen and I have thought about a little bit with at least one of our co-authors, and I hope we'll be thinking about more, is that you can imagine coupling models of network formation together with models of how people behave on networks, right, in order to in order to kind of address this question of network endogeneity when one estimates social interaction models. And I really wish that I had had the time to kind of talk you through one social interaction model that's gone to data. But I don't have that time. So there's this kind of positive use of this, you know, to describe what's happening. Another use is the normative use. So let's think of, there are a number of market problems in the world. You know, the normal markets that we think of, it's like the market for machine screws, right? Every machine screw is like every other machine screw, okay? And we have these people who come and they want machine screws. The product is completely homogeneous. And so the question is, how many do we want to sell? Do we want to sell 500, 1,000, 30 pi, whatever we want, right? Okay. But think about the labor market that you're all going to be entering in diminishing degrees, okay? Every one of you is different, right? Every job that's out there is different, okay? And there might be a job for which you're a great fit and you're not, right? And then there might be another job vice versa, right? So there's a lot of heterogeneity, goods are no longer standardized. And what we want to do is we want to match people up with good. You know, we want to match people up with positions in the right way. Another classic, so that is actually a matching problem. How do we match the right person with the right job? Okay. Another problem that I know that this kind of work has been done in China. How do we choose which schools people should go to? Okay. So we might imagine that there are schools that have a certain number of spaces for students, okay? We might imagine that there are students out there or families out there who have preferences over the different schools, okay? And what we need to do is we need to figure out what is the right way to assign students to schools, okay? And so this problem has been intensively studied to the point where it's boring, actually, okay? And a lot of this work has been done by students of a guy named Al Roth, who is a Nobel Prize winner, along with Lloyd Chapley, who is the greatest game theorist of the 20th century, according to many game theorists. Okay, I'm going to get that in. I'm a big Lloyd Chapley fan. For all of these reasons, both positive and normative, without going into any specific, if you look if you Google the matching literature, Google school matching, school assignment, you'll find this huge literature written by people from Boston, okay? And it's worth taking a look at. It really has to do with how do we design markets, and that's really an interesting thing to do. Okay, so this literature has three pieces to it, okay? There's what I'm gonna call, so we're gonna study bipartite matching, and with bipartite matching, we're gonna talk about labor markets. There's gonna be firms and workers. And firms don't hire firms, they only hire workers. Workers don't go to work for workers, they only work for firms, okay? So there are three kinds of and this, that's bipartite. We have two different kinds of nodes, and every node can only be matched with a node of the other kind. All right, is that clear? Then we're gonna have bipartite matching with transferable utility. Now let me ask, do you all know what transferable utility is? So this is when there is a common good, we'll call it money, and everybody's utility is linear in money. And what that really means is that I can hand you a unit of utility, okay? All right, and there is another version of matching, which is called in the literature non-transferable utility matching, but it's really a misnomer, okay? It really should be called bipartite matching without exchange. Okay, and for those of you who might have heard of this, this is the marriage problem. Okay, the Gail Shapley paper, for instance, and I'll talk about that at the end. And then there's a third thing, which has very few papers written on, hint, opportunity, okay, which is to say bipartite matching with exchange, but without transferable utility. Okay, so that you can trade goods back and forth, you can buy and sell positions, but you can't trade units of utility. That quasi-linearity is really very important. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about bipartite matching with transferable utility, and then this generalizes to bipartite matching without exchange, and then it also generalizes to talking about to applications for thinking about networks. And I'm going to do all of this very, very quickly. Okay. Let me ask you, how many of you have had any exposure to linear programming? You have, right? Anyone else? You have, and probably like half of you have, but you're just too afraid to say so. Actually, it's probably not true. I am actually the last person in the United States to teach linear programming. But I think linear programming is a very good way of understanding a lot of conventional microeconomic theory. And I have extensive lecture notes on it on my course web page at Cornell. And so you're welcome to take a look. It won't be hard to find. You can ask me for the address later, so it's not far off. Okay, so we're going to have two sets of objects. Say workers and firms, and X and Y. And both sides have preferences over who they're matched with. But there are no externalities in these preferences. I don't care who I'm matched with. I don't care who you're matched with if you're of my type. Okay. Now, the literature, the organizing principle is going to be this, what's called a stable match. In order to describe this, let me assume without any loss of generality that Y is the, that X is no bigger than Y. Okay, it's a convenient way to do it. So a match, what do I mean by a match? Actually, the literature calls it not a match, but a matching. A matching is a one-to-one map from X to Y. So it says that you assign to every X to Y. Now, if you've got X to Y, you're going to have some people who aren't matched. Okay, so it goes, that's life. Okay, now a match is going to be stable. If there are no XY pairs, if there are no pairs of this kind, where we have an X and a Y that are matched, an X prime and a Y prime, and Y prime wants to leave and match up with X, and X would rather match up with Y prime than stay with his partner. Okay, so it's like a TV show. Okay? So if Y prime prefers X to her mate, then X prefers his mate to her. Okay? So there's no wife or husband swapping. Okay? That's what we mean by a stable match. Okay? To say it doesn't make for good TV, but it makes for stable societies. So we're going to do this with transferable utility. So I want to think about there being laborers and firms. And I'm going to have, and this is, it is a real number, right? Dollar amount or RMB amount. VLF, this is the surplus which is generated when we match laborer L with firm F. So we're going to imagine that every firm hires only one laborer. And by the way, this can be generalized in many ways, and you can read all about it elsewhere. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to split the surplus from the match, this VLF number, between worker and firm. Okay. So we're going to, if we have worker I working with firm F, worker J working with firm G, we're going to pay I a wage rate WI, J a wage rate WJ, and the firms are going to earn profits pi F and pi G. I'm sorry, that's a typo on the slide. It should be pi F and pi G. Okay. And since this is going to be a division of the surplus, okay, we want to make sure that all the surplus from any match that happens, right, any match that happens, if I F is a match that happens, we want all that surplus to be divided up between the two guys, between the worker and the firm. Okay? Now, suppose that we have I matched with F and J matched with G. And suppose that WI plus pi G is less than VIG. In other words, what does that say? It says that if I breaks off from his firm, G breaks off from her worker, and they get together, they can generate more surplus than what they're currently getting. So they can split that extra, and they do better. All right, so we want that not to happen. All right, so a stability is going to require then that all wage and profit mixes, wage and profit sums, are going to be at least as big as the corresponding as the value of the corresponding match. And then finally, that for those matches that actually happen, for any potential match, this has to be true. Okay? And then for those matches that actually happen, we really do have to be splitting up the surplus. Okay. So here's a way of thinking about this, okay? I'm going to use an indicator variable, LF, will be either 1 or 0, depending upon whether L matches with F or not, okay? And to say that if I take an XLF vector, what's the surplus that's generated? It's VLF times XLF summed over all possible matches, right? Okay. Now, I've got some constraints. Every worker can, every worker can match with only one firm, okay? Every firm can match with only one worker, okay? And that's it. So here we have this integer programming problem, and you know what you can say about integer programming problems? Absolutely nothing, okay? Integer programming problems are really hard. All right, but here's the cool thing, all right? Suppose we allow for fractional matches, okay? If we allow for fractional matches, then this would be a linear programming process, okay? And we can solve a linear program, and we're going to do that in just a minute, sort of, okay? And now the other thing that's interesting about this linear program is that if you think about what linear programs do, how many of you know what linear programs are? What a linear program is, it says maximize a linear function subject to a bunch of linear constraints. Now, if I've got a bunch of linear inequalities of the form ax is less than or equal to b, cx is less than or equal to d, so on and so forth, what am I describing? I'm describing ax is less than or equal to b, that's everything below some line. Right? Cx is less than or equal to d, that's everything below another line. So the intersection of all these things is something that looks like a polygon of some kind. Okay? All right? So it will turn out, now imagine now that I've got this polygon, and then I've got some straight line, and I want to get out as far as I can, subject to still being inside, having a point still inside the polygon. Well, the solution to that, clearly there's going to be a solution at one of the corners. Right? Okay? And the corners are all these integer matches. That's a provable thing. Not only is it provable, this is a remarkable thing, I'm going to waste a little time to say this, but that result has a name. It's called the Birkhoff von Neumann theorem. Now, if you know anything about mathematics, Birkhoff von Neumann, this has to be hard. It's not hard, it's really easy. Okay? I don't know why I got that name, they probably dreamed it up while having a beer. That's either what happens. So if you solve this linear program, right, there one of the solutions will be what's called a vertex solution, and that will be a non-fractional match, and that's the guy we want. Okay? There may be a couple of things. Okay. Alright. So the solution to this linear program is actually going to tell us the value of the socially optimal match. How much we can get by matching everybody up the right way. Okay. Now, every linear program has a dual. This is probably what you don't do, okay? So, you'll notice here, you all know about Lagrange multipliers, right? Okay, so the dual, so you probably know about Lagrange multipliers and derivatives and all that, right? So do you all know that the whole method of Lagrange multipliers of the Kuhn-Tucker theorem works whenever you have a concave objective function of any kind, differentiable or not? Okay, and whenever you have a convex constraint set, you probably didn't learn it this way, but this is true. Okay, and the way one proves this stuff is by, instead of doing derivative calculations, you use separating hyperplane arguments. And if you look at my lecture notes online, you can see how to do that. So the dual says, write down the Lagrange multipliers for this. The dual is the problem of finding the multipliers. Okay. So there's some intuition for you, right? So what do the Lagrange multipliers do in a Lagrangian problem? They tell you the value of relaxing one of the constraints, right? So you have one dual price for every constraint, okay? In this problem, you've got a bunch of worker constraints, right? That means you're going to have one dual price for every worker constraint. We call those wages. Aha. Okay? And then we've got a bunch of firm constraints, so we're going to have one dual price for every firm constraint. We call those profits. Okay? Now, what does the dual look like? So here's where you have to do the magic of linear programming. There is a programming problem, and here's the programming problem. Okay? By the way, if you actually write down the Lagrange and you do the saddle point theorem, this is the problem of finding the saddle point. It's exactly that. All right, and I'm not going to say anymore. For some of you, that doesn't mean anything. Don't worry about it. For others of you, it's a hint as to why this might be true. There's a couple of you who actually understand this probably better than I do. All right. So what is the this is the dual problem. Theorems of linear programming says that if the primal has a solution, if and only if the dual has a solution. And we know the primal has a solution, so the dual will have a solution. The value of the dual will equal the value of the primal. Okay? And then there's another condition that says it's called complementary slackness. Okay? And the complementary slackness condition says, okay, that essentially it says that if this left-hand side is strictly greater than the right-hand side, then the corresponding variable XLF, the match variable, has to be zero. Okay? And that's kind of the same thing as basically saying that if the if a constraint in a Lagrangian problem is actually not a binding constraint, then the multiplier has to be zero. That's what it says. Okay? So now let's put all that stuff together. Well, the value of a dual solution has to equal the value of the primal solution. In other words, the solution of this will divide up all the social surplus. Secondly, we've got exactly the stability condition that we wanted, namely that for any worker firm pair, right, the sum of what the worker and the firm is getting is at least as much as they could get if they were together. Okay? And complementary slackness says that if XLF is 1, then the right-hand side has to equal the left-hand side. So it says for those matches that actually happen, this constraint is tight. Okay? Which means we're dividing up all the surplus. So what does that say? That tells us that the dual solution is, in fact, a set of, if we take the matching and we take the dual solution, we have a stable arrangement. We have a stable payoff. Okay? So we achieve stability through the dual. Okay? Now, furthermore, this actually has even more welfare properties. Some of you might have heard of something called the core. I'm not going to talk about the core, but it turns out this is a core solution as well. It has a lot of strong welfare properties. Okay, this is the story of matching and transferable utility. Okay, and you should think about it tonight because I think it might come up again tomorrow. Okay. All right. So a matching is stable if and only if it's optimal. Each labor. Okay. This is, forget all the proofs. That's the main theorem. And I'm not going to talk about assortative matching. Is that all right? You want to talk about it? Should I talk about it now?
Well, I'll talk about it tomorrow.
Okay, here's the assortative matching slide. Memorize it right now. Okay. So let me talk quickly about the generalization. So we can do this we can ask the same question, right, without having dollars gauges, okay? I'm sorry that the symbol didn't come out right now, fix that. So, and this is the subject of a 1962 paper by David Gale and Lloyd Chapley. And this is kind of like the least thing that Lloyd Chapley ever did, okay? But Lloyd nonetheless managed to win a Nobel Prize for it. I have lots of Lloyd Chapley stories. And this paper was published in a journal which is published for high school math teachers, right? And you should all read this paper because they have some nice comments at the end about what it means to do mathematics and why even idiots should try, okay? And they kind of say it that way too. It's a little bit. They were young men then. All right. So this is a generalization, and this has been very important for a number of different. This is important, for example, for the school matching problem, and it's one direction to go in. So let me now talk about something else called the roommate problem. The roommate problem is, let's forget that we have workers and firms. Suppose that we're all one big population, and we have a bunch of apartments, okay, each of which can hold two people. And now what we want to do is we want to match people up. So this is now, instead of having, this is not longer a bipartite matching problem, it's a unipartite matching problem. Well, here's kind of, the sad fact is that stable matches may not exist, right? And here's a very quick example. Suppose we have three people, okay? And the payoff to 2 and 3 matching is 1. The payoff to 1 and 2 to 1 and 3 matching is 2, okay? And the payoff to 1 and 2 matching is 3, okay? So 1, 2 is the best match, and it gets 3. 1, 3 is the second best match and it gets 2. And 2, 3 is the worst match and it gets 1. Okay? And then if you don't get matched, you're left up against zero. Okay? If you actually check, work with those numbers, play with it a little bit, you see that there's no stable match. Right? Because any division of any surplus, the guy who's getting zero can bid like the guy, you know, someone out. Okay? That's what's going on. Despite the fact that the roommate problem has no stable match, right? Matt Jackson, and there's another name that I left off here, I really wrote this quickly, Ashley Walensky wrote a paper in the Journal of Economic Theory where they said, let's use this idea to talk about stable networks, okay? And they did this in the non-transferable utility case, which is going to be even harder, even though we already know that the roommate problem with transferable utility, which should be easy, is what we call a mess, technically, okay? And what they show is that they had this idea that says, we'll define what it means to have a stable network. And the idea of having a stable network is that every network has a value to every individual. Right? And that value can depend upon the entire network structure. Okay? But of course, the art is going to be to find network structures where, you know, maybe it depends only on stuff related to you, or it depends upon you in interesting ways. And then the idea is, so their idea of a stable match is the following, just generalizing is, there should be no match which would benefit both parties that hasn't already been made. Right? So if we have a matching, and if you two guys are not matched, and we throw a link between, it's not matching, it's throwing a link. If we throw a link between you, it's going to give us a new network. It cannot be the case, if this is a stable network, that utility goes up in a Pareto sense for both of you, right? One of you has to, if it's good for you, it's got to be bad for you, okay? The other thing is that nobody wants to drop a link, or maybe nobody wants to drop all their links, or nobody wants to drop any subset of their links, okay? Theorem number one, stable matches, stable networks do not always exist, okay? And then after that, Jackson and Walensky work out a number of examples where they do exist, and you can see that they might be kind of cool. Now, why do we actually do that? This is my last comment because we're like 3 minutes over, okay? The reason why they do that is because how can we even form, you know, what you would be tempted to do is to write down a non-cooperative game, right? Where the strategies would, you know, where we play this game and the outcome would be a network. Well, let's think about what that game would be. What would be a strategy in that game? A strategy is an action that you have to take, and that you have to take, right, and that I have to take, and somehow this is going to generate a network. Well, let's think about what the social rules could be. How can we even implement that? So, I want to make a link with you. Well, maybe automatically that means there's a link. Or maybe you have the right to say, no, I don't want to touch you, go away. You know, we don't even know how to write down such a game. And there could be, you know, a continuum almost of different kinds of games like this. So, although the matching problem comes out of thinking about cooperative game theory things, which you probably not had a lot of exposure to, there is a chapter in Moscow and Stephen Green. I don't know if you use that book here, and if you have, but it's available from your favorite Russian website. I suggest you take a look at it if you're interested in serious economics. And so even though this comes out of a different branch of game theory, the idea here is that in any reasonable game, any reasonable solution concept that we might imagine, right, where a Nash equilibrium in any reasonable game ought to have the property that there are no Pareto gains that are left on the table and that nobody wants to print. Okay? Now I actually think that only half of that is true. Because in fact, if we're playing a large game, right? Maybe you know, between Jeff and me, there'd be a great match, but he's at the back of the room. I barely see him, you know? So, you know, the search becomes an issue here. And by the way, that's a really unexplored area. That's hint number two, okay, for thesis topics. I think there's a lot of interesting stuff to be in here. I think the issues of strategic, you hear a lot of talk about strategic, you know, endogenous networks and strategic network formation and stuff. I think there's actually too much of that talk, but there's still actually good work to be done here, and I hope some of you guys do it. Thank you for listening.